You might get a good photograph out of this.
If Bertie was to do all these things again, he wouldn't have done them, I'm sure.
You've got to decode Bertie.
Bertie Ahern resigned under a cloud. His personal finances no longer made sense.
There was no favour sought, no favours given.
He brought to a close a remarkable decade in the Taoiseach's office.
He was always looking for a way through because he grasped the big picture.
He was the most popular politician of his day, though always an elusive and contradictory figure.
That's not good to say.
I mean, you can never ever know a person fully, and that would be the true of Dad.
Religious, but whose wife was not his official partner.
That was really a very difficult time.
Outgoing, but with few friends in government.
Is he ruthless? Yes, that streak is there.
Anyone that's gone on in life has stepped, maybe not in the toes, could be on the fucking head.
Bertie Ahern took pride in his modest lifestyle, yet money would tarnish his image like others before him.
The way that he was seen by your average member of the organisation, yeah, that was bad.
Bertie Ahern today brought down the curtain on a remarkable political career.
Certainly disliked the fact that a tribunal had been able, in effect, to remove him from office. That is how he saw it.
After a lifetime in politics, the contradictions remain. Who is the real Bertie Ahern?
Now at the end, I'll submit to the verdict of history.
The state of the parties at just about 12:30. Fianna Fáil 60, Fine Gael 30. Certainly Fianna Fáil are going to form the next government.
I think this is a total shock. The Irish people succeeded in keeping this a secret from everybody.
I would say that Bertie didn't think he could get elected.
Ahern plus 247.
I didn't even watch the count because I really didn't think he'd be anywhere.
Giving a total of 4,518.
This was a young guy who wasn't even a councillor, who had no political experience of having stood in any campaign.
By far their best total ever.
1977 was, there was a landslide. He was lucky in that he was in the right place at the right time.
And let's try and update the list of candidates elected. A new candidate taking a seat for Fianna Fáil and Dublin Finglas, Ahern.
I suppose 1977 catapulted the whole lot of us into really a different life.
He was a nobody, first of all. So, and he had no pedigree. He came from nowhere.
I was born in Drumcondra. My father was farm manager for the Vincentians in All Hallows College. So, very much our life and my life to all the way through has been Drumcondra. My parents were from Cork.
And they were very proud of their country roots. There was five of us in the family. There was three boys and two girls. My mother was very quiet, gentle, patient. My father was very gregarious, sociable. He was strict. He was strict on all of us.
Bertie was the youngest, born in the middle of 1951.
Although we lived in Church Avenue, we had All Hallows College on our doorstep.
All Hallows College would have been a serious farm in the middle of the city. I mean, they had a lot of cattle, pigs, they had chickens, they had crops.
Bertie would be helping his father. He used to plough with a horse, and Bertie used to help him a lot. We used to call Bertie the Colchie.
He was very much this mixture, this blend of city and country. Bertie was the youngest, so he was the baby. The rest of us would probably have thought he had life a bit easier.
At school, he wasn't anything brilliant at school. He was very, very ordinary. He was a late developer, if you like to put it like that.
From the earliest age, however, one thing held the attention of Bartholomew Patrick Ahern.
Sports, every sport. I mean, that was our fun. I played a lot of hurling. There was a big Drums fan, Drumcondra League of Ireland in those days. And Alhullas had all the facilities.
The Aherns were fairly well known for sport, but not for politics.
Bertie had been to every athletics meeting, soccer match, Gaelic match. First time we went to Croke Park with him, we were lifted in by Morrison Knoll.
We were on committees, organised street matches, and Bertie was doing the same thing.
He always wanted to be captain of the team. Yeah, he liked the leadership role. Because I remember even one time, I'd had some row in a match, but Bertie said he was going to report me to the board.
Bertie Ahern had a talent for organisation and a sense of his rightful place at the head of it. Through sport, he created a network of friends who would one day help launch his political career.
One of the biggest things we shared was our interest in sport. Bertie, with a group of us, founded Alhampton Football Club.
It was a very organised team. I mean, we had hot showers when I don't think the League of Ireland clubs had. We were physical guys. We were able to handle ourselves.
He would avoid getting into trouble, getting into a confrontation. But if he got in, he was in, and he was going to stay, and it didn't matter how bad a hammering you got.
If you ran up against him, you'd know you were there. He's a big man.
I didn't like guys going by me, so I suppose I got the reputation of them. But I was never put off, never got a red card.
He'd delay you, as the fella said.
We were always a family to discuss issues. You know, there was great debate going on around the table all the time, really, about the issues of the day.
Discussion wasn't likely to be one way, to be honest. It came down from the parents, and that was it.
We only bought the Irish press. We only voted Fianna Fáil. We only wanted to know what Deb said.
We would have had quite a number of history books in the house. Bertie was big into history. There was one book in particular that was almost like his Bible. It's a small, slim little book called How Ireland is Governed. That book was very much about, you know, Ireland as a democracy and then, you know, the whole organisation of government.
I loved history. I was still in secondary school when I read a book about how Dáil Éireann works. You know, I was watching the system around the streets. I mean, you know, Fianna Fáil were strong in that area, some of the families.
My husband was in Fianna Fáil, and Bertie used to put out leaflets and all like that for him. He'd be up there at election day giving out leaflets and that, you know. He was into it from day one.
Politically, Bertie would have grown up knowing about that we were very strong Republican.
My father was in the old IRA.
It was in the Civil War that he was very active.
He was interned in the Curragh for 2 years.
A bit bitter that he was put away, probably wondering who squealed on him.
This is BBC Northern Ireland.
Ulster stands at the crossroads.
It is clear now that the present situation cannot be allowed to continue.
It was a Republican household. The temper was took a lot of control in those days, 68, 69. I mean, their streets were burning down. These people were being attacked. There was no protection for them. I mean, where was the resistance movement in the north, whoever they were?
The man who would one day negotiate away the Republic's claim to the north held, at that time, uncompromising views.
It would have been sort of basic republicanism. Brits out, that the northern entity had failed.
From the time we heard about Bloody Sunday on the Sunday night, we were fairly incensed.
Only Bertie Ahern's closest friends knew that he was present in a crowd which burnt the British Embassy in February 1972.
In 72, I was there. I mean, I was there for those nights with my brothers and with my friends. We were there. I mean, we were incensed about that.
Would you have ever joined the IRA?
No, I never did. I mean, friends of mine did, and I played an active movement in it, and I knew a lot of them. I think if I hadn't been in you know, a Fianna Fáil household, yeah, maybe I would have.
He did talk a lot about Sean Lamass at that stage, and that was the only inkling that this guy is talking about something other than Drumcondra Football Club or the Dubs.
Few then knew where Bertie Ahern's real ambitions lay. In 1971, he had joined his local Fianna Fáil Cumann and saw that it was ripe for a shake-up.
He was a member of the O'Donovan Ross Cumann in Drumcondra. The positions would have been held by elderly people at that stage, you know. It was a night out, cup of tea, discuss what happened back in 1916 and all that sort of thing. He persuaded me to join the Cumann.
He already had a group of young men, young Turks around him, mainly connected with football and with sport in general.
He asked me, would I get involved in the other Cumann in Drumcondra called Dick McKee, and I became secretary of that. And effectively, he had a base then in Drumcondra. He had two Cumann in Drumcondra that he could rely on. Bertie, I think, saw an opportunity.
He was always the manoeuvre. He was two or three steps ahead of everyone, you know? It's just, you know? He had that ability to do that.
Drumcondra effectively was and still is a village. And the people there, families upon families, they all have grown up in the area. We were entwined socially in all sorts of ways.
Marion was very much around Drumcondra. I mean, she lived beside Co Park and she was a Drumcondra person. She was come to the matches. A few of my friends were going out with her friends.
I was really attracted to him. I mean, he's lovely eyes. I think everybody agrees about that. And he'd wild hair, and at the time everybody had short backs and sides. When I met Bertie, I also started attending Fianna Fáil meetings with him. It was another lovely date. I think, you know, yeah, we did sort of very, very early on agree that our feel that we were going to get married, and we planned for that. We started saving.
By the mid-70s, Bertie Ahern had quietly established a power base in his native Drumcondra.
When he first arrived in, he was very meek and very much in the background, very quiet. But all the time, he was obviously working. He was very inconspicuous at the time. I knew nothing about him. But he had two or three of the, as I now know, at the time I didn't know who they were, he had two or three of the mafias that were around him.
By the 1977 election, he was ready to show his hand. At just 25, Bertie Ahern was added to the Fianna Fáil ticket at the last minute.
He was allowed on the ticket to kind of sweep up votes in the southern part of the constituency, the Drumcondra end.
The opportunity was there was a young man there who was from that area, so put him on and let's see what he does.
In 77, Bertie Ahern was fishing for the same votes as two experienced Fianna Fáilers, local councillor Danny Bell and sitting TD Jim Tunney.
Jim Tunney was the Yellow Rose of Finglas, you know, that was his nickname.
I'd say to you.
He was a part of the hierarchy in the party.
I think Jim thought we were nice guys at the start. I think at the end it was slightly different.
Neither Jim Tunney nor Danny Bell saw him as any threat.
This guy, with hair all over the head, he moved at such a rate that, like, the other guys didn't know what he was up to. Said, let the young fella do it.
The numbers that we were able to put out in the street, because Bertie was well known from football and friends who were quite willing to give him a dig out and help. Yeah.
So we decided that this was really our territory. Times got a bit physical, but we protected it very, very closely.
Vote the number one candidate, Bertie Ahern.
These were all kids, these were all young students that didn't have a clue. They just knew to run up the door, vote number one, Bertie Ahern, and run.
The rules and regulations, none of us knew anything about them. We didn't drive a horse and coach through them, we pushed the train sideways through them.
They were not interested in Fianna Fáil. Good, bad or indifferent, they were interested in one name, Bertie Ahern, and nothing else. I'm gonna be late. Bertie Ahern, Bertie Ahern, Bertie Ahern, and nothing else.
While the results of all the counts are not yet available, the indications are that there will be a change of government.
People are stunned back there, including the Fianna Fáil people. Nobody realised that this was happening.
I remember the Sunday before saying on This Week, if Fianna Fáil get back, it'll be the greatest comeback since Lazarus.
And shock news, the state of the parties.
Fianna Fáil, I think, have 83 or 84. I'm cross-eyed at the moment, so I'm not quite...
Not alone did Lazarus come back, he brought an awful lot of his pals with him.
And we've just heard from Dublin West County, Liam Lawler of Fianna Fáil Inn.
The count was incredibly exciting. It was very hard for us to read what was happening on the ground.
I don't think it was in Bertie's mind that he would actually be elected.
The Labour and Fine Gael tally men, they gave us an indication that Bertie was well in with the shout. We had to ring Miriam and say, Miriam, get in here quick.
We said, well, maybe, gosh, maybe you could do it, you know. And, but we said, no, don't think like that.
As the votes began to pile up, it was clear that Ahern was being swept along in a shock Fianna Fáil landslide. Around 10:30 that night, the unthinkable happened. Bertie Ahern, TD.
And Finglas Ahern, a new man in.
Oh, when he did win, it was just unbelievable. At this stage, he was saying, God, what am I going to do? Where will I go? And
I knew nothing about the setup in Dáil-Éireann. I didn't know which was the front door or the back door, or whether it was a car park or anything else.
Bertie Ahern began his Dáil career in his mid-20s. With no family connections, he had succeeded at his first and possibly last attempt.
There's no doubt that it was the beginning of the rest of his life.
Yeah, it was, because if I wasn't elected in 77, I don't think I ever would have ran again.
We had this new influx of TDs, and we had this massive majority.
I remember seeing, being on the Dáil Gallery, when 84 Fianna Fáilers walked into the chamber. They couldn't be accommodated on the government benches. They spilled over into the opposition.
At that time, Albert Reynolds came in.
Charlie McCreevy.
Pádraig Flynn.
Liam Lawler in Dublin.
And Mary Harney came into the Senate after that. Like, all the people who more or less for around 20-odd years.
Nobody had heard of Bertie Ahern at that stage, and he wasn't that prominent in the party.
Bertie was just part of the crowd. He didn't kind of impinge on the consciousness of most people.
We never paid any attention whatsoever to Bertie Ahern. We didn't know who he was.
An ordinary dub, not very ambitious, it was thought, and not going to antagonise anybody. He was in the background.
And certainly Bertie Ahern went out of his way to conceal his potential from many of the people in Leinster House, and particularly from his colleagues and indeed from the media. And nobody, I think, would have given him a chance, not only of not being Taoiseach, but perhaps ever being a cabinet minister.
Did you think here is a man who's going to one day lead this party?
No. And I doubt whether there was any other person in the Fianna Fáil party at that time would have thought it either.
Ahern is an ambitious man. People don't realise quite how ambitious he is. He's ambitious and he's organised.
4 or 5 months after the 1977 election, some of the members of the team met out in Malahide. The purpose of the meeting was to decide how Bertie could become Taoiseach in 20 years.
It was put together by a gang of people that believed he was going to be Taoiseach, regardless of what happened. He put a team around him, and it was all built very, very cleverly.
I don't think I've ever met any other politician, and I know plenty of them, you know, who planned like that to go right to the top. So that ambition was there from the beginning.
The ambitions of others, though, were plain to see.
We knew how he was coming. There was no doubt about the fact that how he was coming. Lynch was tired. He'd been around for a long time, and that period in opposition had been very hard.
Leadership races usually start on an undercurrent considerably before the actual time arrives. And in this case, of course, it came rather suddenly and unexpectedly.
As I announced at the Fianna Fáil party meeting this morning, I have decided to resign as Taoiseach.
With Lynch gone, anxious TDs scrambled to back the winning horse in the leadership race.
People's seats were at risk and they became very, very nervous.
But who would Ahern support? Party favourite George Colley or prodigal son Charles Haughey?
Many times I've heard that, you know, Haughey would have assumed totally that I would have been supporting. And I was lobbied like everybody else by both sides. Like, of all my coming, all the people who worked with me, of all of the people in Drumcondra had said, listen, no, go the other way. I mean, I wouldn't have ignored that.
He wasn't slavish in terms of his admiration of Haughey, because he always had his own base, which was his constituency, which was absolutely personal to him. It did not really depend on the party. He had built it up himself. But in the end of the day, Haughey was the one that he could see going somewhere. Charlie would reward service, as indeed he did.
The result was Charles Haughey, 44, George Colley, 38.
You have no idea the panic. I mean, total panic. It was crazy.
It wasn't just a change of personalities. It was like belonging to a completely different organisation. They were extraordinary years in many ways.
The party was divided. Criminations were wholesale. Terrible. Terrible.
A ghost that will haunt the Fianna Fáil party for years to come.
The main government party seems to be tearing itself apart in public.
There was a lot of bullying, a lot of aggression, a lot of intimidation.
Well, that's a load of rubbish.
When people talk in corridors, if you're seen with one, you know, then you were marked by the other.
Dear Taoiseach, I am hereby submitting my resignation. I write to tender my resignation.
Meetings were fought with an intensity of people who were the pro-Haughey side, the anti-Haughey side. It was exciting.
And I want to assure all the people throughout the country, all the people,
nerve-wracking,
who have given their lives to Fianna Fáil, who love Fianna Fáil as I do.
Some TDs had a very, very difficult time.
Don't worry. Your party is in good hands. We look after it for you.
Bertie Ahern was plunged into the middle of this civil war. Haughey had appointed him a party whip, and Ahern was sent out to defend the boss.
Well, I said yesterday, it was very clear that I didn't think he would resign today. I'm still saying that.
But still, he kept people guessing about his personal views.
The Taoiseach addressed the meeting, we were told.
He has spoken.
Did he get an ovation at the meeting?
I'm not going to say.
I can never remember any of those ferocious meetings that we had at the parliamentary party of Bertie ever making a comment that antagonised anybody.
What has been discussed so far?
The motion.
The motion has been discussed. Yeah. What views have been expressed on it?
I'm not going to say.
In fact, now that I think about it, during all those heaves, and nearly everybody spoke at the parliamentary party, I don't think Bertie ever spoke.
I take the minutes of the meeting, the head was down, so...
Didn't seem to be getting to the middle of the turmoil like some of the rest of us. And he'll obviously live it off a lot longer.
We must regroup, reorganise ourselves and get on with the job. The past is past.
During the Gooboo years, Bertie Ahern would have to prove his loyalty to the boss time and again.
You have the serious repercussions for the country.
Decided that the Special Committee of Inquiry would investigate the issues as a matter of the utmost urgency.
In 1983, it emerged that journalists' phones had been tapped on the orders of a Fianna Fáil minister. Bertie Ahern was appointed to a committee investigating the scandal.
We feel that the organisation and the other members of the parliamentary party wish us to get on with this investigation and to get it finished as quickly as possible.
The Tunney Committee was a farce. It was set up by Mr. Haughey. The first words that Mr. Tunney uttered when he became chairman of the committee was that there's no problem here and there's really nothing to answer.
Charles Haughey, the party leader, had no involvement in the matter.
So the not guilty verdict was given in advance of our deliberations, which was a strange way to conduct an inquiry.
A decade on, however, the minister who had ordered the tapping would assert that Charles Haughey had been centrally involved.
I think they made as good a chance as you can of finding the facts, and if you never easy find facts.
He didn't find the facts because it turned out, as we found out later, that Haughey did know about the topic.
Yeah, well, Sean Doherty said that he clearly knew about it, but it, the committee was never going into every last an individual person.
You do what you're told. You did what you're told by Mr. Haughey.
As Bertie Ahern rose through the whip's office, he showed he would toe the party line to protect Haughey, but he wouldn't pick a fight with his enemies. Ahern watched as Fianna Fáil tore itself apart and drew his own lessons for the future.
You see, there's one thing I have to say to you about Bertie. Bertie had this passion in life that when Haughey was running, Bertie wanted to get more number ones than Charlie. And Bertie didn't care how he got them.
Unless you win your seat, unless you control your constituency, well, then you are seen as weak.
I've never been able to detect in Bertie Ahern any abiding political passion about a belief or a principle, other than being there, other than being in power.
Above all else, Bertie Ahern's priority was always his vote, an obsession honed in the back-to-back elections of the early 1980s.
Three heaves, three general elections, non-stop trauma. It was tough work, but it was tough work.
We actually galvanised his workers into saying, well, whatever happens, you're not losing your seat.
The threat to Ahern's seat was real enough. In 1981, his Drumcondra base was moved into the political cockpit of Dublin Central.
When Ahern came in first into Dublin Central, he knew who was a threat and who wasn't. There was an attempt to destroy whatever chance I had of getting elected. A group of people went around putting up posters identifying me as a H-block candidate. I put that down to Ahern. His organisation was the only one that had the ability to do that. My experience of rivalry was with the late George Colley, which would have been not troublesome, but would have been adventurous, to say the least.
George Colley used to come from either Rathmines or Rathgar, but anyway, it was something with an aura. It was on the south side, and he had an aura about him.
This was literally David and Goliath.
It was three TDs for getting two Fianna Fáil seats, and one of them happened to be the tarnished George Colley.
Colleyites, they weren't up against a Fianna Fáil organisation, they were up against a personal organisation that Bertie had around them.
See you soon. Thanks very much. Bye-bye.
We did things differently. We were effectively in a sales mode. We were selling the name of Bertie Ahern across the door to the people. Buy this man. This is a good product.
Now, the state of the poll following the first count is as follows. Bertie Ahern, Fianna Fáil, 8,738.
In 81, they did not believe that I would be elected. When we headed the poll, then I think that changed the issue.
We were all enormously surprised to find out how well he did in relation to Colley.
Were you a little disappointed, perhaps, at not heading the poll?
Well, let me put it this way. Perhaps I'm more used to heading the poll than otherwise.
And I think that's when people began to realise that he was a real political force.
We were hearing funny rumours about yourself and George Colley.
Not at all. I think there's just some media speculation.
And that's when people began to look at that extraordinary machine that he has.
Tell me about Operation Dublin.
Well, I don't know where you got that one.
Some people actually refer to it as the slaughter of the innocent.
We had a lot of Cummins in those days. I think it was 105 or 110 Cummins.
Paper Cummins, no delegates, no meetings, no nothing.
There's no point in having 60 Cummins and 50 members.
Bertie wanted complete control. Of course, he got permission to get Operation Dublin running.
You get the idea that you can pull one over on someone. And that's what politics is about. This town is coming like a ghost. So they put out the word, get rid of the Cummins. All the clubs are being
closed down.
It was a railroad from the start.
This place.
Some of us got our foot into a few commons. When a meeting was held of elderly people who spent years in Fianna Fáil, they were gone and they didn't know what hit them.
There'd be skin and hair flying at the meetings.
Oh, there was a lot of fighting.
But there would be literally fisticuffs. I have seen fisticuffs. People
getting angry. What he did was he wiped out the Fianna Fáil organisation at Dublin Central and brought in a parallel organisation that's operated ever since.
Within that structure, again, he would create ward bosses, which is taken directly from Chicago mob in the 30s.
We were given an area, that was your area, you looked after it, got to know the people, got to know the streets, got to know the houses.
And it was a great honour to be a ward. I was a ward boss. When you're told you're a ward boss, you know, it's like something out of Goodfellas. You feel like you're one of these made men. You're one of the 12.
We were always referred to as the Drumcondra Mafia. And it wasn't until recently that I actually discovered that it was Hockey who actually called us and referred to us as the Drumcondra Mafia.
The machine in Drumcondra takes no prisoners. Anybody that's opposed to them, they set out to really destroy and ground them into the, you know, to make sure that they had no way back.
There were lots and lots of people whose ambitions were cut short in those days.
Bertie, like any other good politician, like all his predecessors, if you want to get somewhere, you have to go for it. Anyone that's gone on in life has stepped, maybe not on their toes, could be on their fucking head.
Don't mess with Bertie's machine.
I'd like to ask the people in the flats, do they give a damn about their children?
Bertie Ahern had made Dublin Central his own, but in the 80s, it was a community tearing itself apart over drugs and crime.
But the one that put the knife to a fucking throat, I won't knife up, I'll fucking bleeding kneecap up.
He was their leader, he must follow them.
Would you not have thought you'd be better off the street the last few nights?
People were dying in our area. With marches on houses, and Bertie'd be there. I mean, that was the nasty thing about it. Like, you more or less had to go along with the people.
We had the highest unemployment in the country. We had the highest deprivation under every category, whether it was heroin addicts or whatever it was.
Bertie got dug in there and didn't call back now, didn't hold back.
Were you down when the Mercedes was born?
I was standing there when the Mercedes was born.
I did take a tough line, but I took a tough line from my constituency.
The hard-working Dublin TD was beginning to make a name for himself as a no-nonsense man of the people.
My memory of that press interview was there were no unguarded comments. There were, I suppose, something, you know, in retrospect, some unusual comments. How many pints do you reckon you could drink and be able to drive? And his answer was, I could certainly drink a fair few pints of Bass and be capable of driving. He talked about being outspoken about the guards on occasion. For a week after, you're kind of careful how many pints or glasses you drink. I mean, I think as a working politician, he had a constituency to which he had to appeal.
Ahern's machine, though, delivered more than just votes. At a time of economic despair, hundreds of people turned to it for help.
So I had 14 constituency clinics up and down the area, and people know me well and involved with them all the time.
I mean, I remember when I started first, you might have 30 or 40 people at an advice centre.
We used to have to police the clinics to stop people skipping the queue.
We're always aware of people coming up to him, asking questions, looking for help or advice, and him always willing to help people.
And to assist with the constituency workload, a new member joined the team.
Celia was very important in Bertie's life, in his personal life and in his political life. They got on extremely well together. She started working for him when he was chief whip. She built up the constituency office in Drumcondra, and she put in place all the systems, which are still in place, computerised his whole constituency work long before any other TD. So she was extremely important politically.
Celia Larkin, she was very important to this operation.
No.
I would say that the majority of us wouldn't be that mad about her.
She came to work with me as a full-time constituency secretary, running the operation to service what was a very busy constituency. She was superb.
In the social circle at times, it could be quite tense and difficult.
You know, she would say it as she saw it.
You know, she had staked her claim. This was her space. And basically, people had to skirt about that.
And she just called the shots, and that was it. He did what he was told.
All right, then, ladies and gentlemen, let's have a welcome, please, for Yvonne Dolan and her Keep Fit fanatics. Here they are. Watch.
Right, and left, and right, and left. Now, elbows back, two, three, and open on four, again, and one.
Fianna Fáil spent the mid-80s out of office, and the role of an opposition TD is hard to envy. There's a need to keep yourself in the public eye, but without the power to really change things. Bertie Ahern, though, kept his local career on track.
It is my great joy to declare my friend elected Lord Mayor Dublin.
It was huge, and probably the job I enjoyed most in my career. I loved being a Lord Mayor of Dublin. It gave me an opportunity to go into every part of this city and county.
And while still in the Mansion House, Ahern made his breakthrough in national politics. Fianna Fáil scraped home in the 1987 election, holding off a challenge from the newly formed PDs.
I know f***ing better about seeing you, though. Are you? You're sharing a lot of you.
Bertie Ahern, of course, came home with almost two quotas.
Still in his mid-30s, Bertie Ahern was given his first department as Minister for Labour.
Minister for Labour was a key position because he was involved in industrial relations disputes week in and week out.
What he did owe to Haughey was the fact that Haughey was the one that realised that behind that sort of slightly shambling presentation was a real mind.
So now he's in the hot seat.
Today, the budget deficit is at a continuous increase in unemployment, massive debt burden, large-scale mergers and rationalisation.
Entire families had given up. They could see no future for their children.
People were leaving the country at the rate of 40 to 50,000 a year. They were fleeing the country.
I have four graduates in my family, and they're all abroad.
Public spending and public borrowing is unsustainable. It's been very much a downhill slide.
Every time you switch on the television on a Friday, more factories closing.
You've got to be quite clear about it. We're in the middle of the worst recession in the history of the state.
I just can't. I can't get work anywhere. Like, I'm working at McDonald's at the moment, you know, with the law degree.
No hope. No future. And people had given up on the country.
The new government's response to economic crisis was brutally simple.
Thousands of public service jobs must go to reduce public spending costs.
I mean, it was very grim. It was really grim. Ray McSharry told us all, you have to cut and cut and cut and cut again.
If you talk to a public servant at that point in time, they didn't frighten their kids anymore with the boogeyman, they just threatened them with Ray McSharry.
Cut, 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 cut. You faced daily outrage at what you were doing.
While McSharry wielded the knife, Ahern dressed the wounds. He made his name as the government strike fixer, on call day and night.
ESP were the first up. They were going to go on strike and Ireland was to be plunged into darkness.
And what do you think of it?
What the hell? It's bloody disgrace!
I remember Charlie being quite stern with Bertie. Now he said, I'm telling you, Ahern, there's no give, there's to be no give to the ESB. And Bertie would say, oh, sure, Taoiseach, sure, sure.
I mean, I was advised, in my department at the time, don't get involved in this stuff. This could damage you. And I said, this is the department of what? And they said, Labour.
I'm only doing it purely as the Minister of Labour, as the referee to try to bring the sides together.
He kind of stood out as very different from the people who were dominating Fianna Fáil at that time. This guy with the long hair and anorak and exaggerated Dublin accent, who seemed to be one of the lads.
Well, he was active in the union. When he was very young, he was active in the union.
My impression was that Bertie was a great deal maker, as long as he had loads of other people's money to do the deals with.
There was no week that we were not in the Department of Labour. At least two nights, all night.
1 o'clock, 1:15, 1:30. He was sitting on a bench over on the canal, talking to one of the trade union officials. He said, I had to get into that guy's head, see where he's coming from.
If you don't understand where they're coming from, then you cannot successfully negotiate. It comes with talking to people, ringing on Sundays, chit-chat, listening to people, trying to find out, and that comes with a lot of hours.
And at about 4 o'clock in the morning, we squeezed out an agreement and got us back to the next crisis.
If we didn't do business with a government, we were going to go out of business, not just nationally, but as unions.
It was clear the cycle of strikes and closures had to be broken. In 1987, talks began to bring government, employers and unions together in a social partnership deal to save the economy.
The bones of the deal were, in return for low or no pay increases, that we would try and create growth in the economy. And if we did generate that growth, it would help employment, it would improve the national finances. That's what it was about.
Bertie's role simply was to convince Hockey that we could do business and could be trusted. Hockey in turn's role was to convince the employers that the whole thing could be delivered.
They twisted a lot of arms. There were some very bruised people around at that point in time because everybody had to make concessions. He never allowed his ego to come between or enter into the process. I don't recall him ever losing his temper. People often see it as a sign of weakness or to say it's indecisiveness, but it's not. It is very, very calculated.
We did have long sessions on pay into the night. I know the pay agreement was agreed at about 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning.
Basically because trade union people believed that a deal that was done at 3 o'clock in the afternoon couldn't possibly be a good deal.
This programme presents by far the best chance of coping simultaneously with the enormous problems of the public finances, unemployment, excessive taxes.
There was much greater confidence. People began to believe now that the very serious crisis we're in at least was beginning to be tackled.
I mean, there isn't in economic history a revival of an economy, a regeneration of an economy, to the extent that we did here.
This quiet revolution is being achieved without strikes or other industrial trouble.
Social partnership would define Bertie Ahern's own approach to government in years to come. But his rise to the front rank of politics had taken a personal toll.
I think in any life, when you're working a lot of hours, when you're not at home, when your concentration is always on something else, when you're not giving your best maybe to your own life, you know, you get into difficulties, and that's inevitable.
See, I wouldn't like to be any woman in Bertie's life, to be honest with you, because there'd be a lot of doing without now, to be honest.
Politics was the main driving force for him, and It's like a drug in a way. Once you get in on it, it's very hard to leave it, you know.
I was very happy for him to receive the recognition. To be Lord Mayor of Dublin was a great honour. And then for him to be Minister for Labour again, that's in Dáil terms, he was furthering his career. But it was a time also that I was very disappointed in him, that he seemed to withdraw from family life and from me, and I couldn't really understand that. That was really a very difficult time.
It It was traumatic. It's traumatic for everybody. It's traumatic, you know, it's traumatic for Miriam, it's traumatic for me, it's traumatic to those close to you. And you just do your best.
I don't think we were ever told, and this is part of the shock, I think it was while Bertie was Lord Mayor, that it was apparent that his relationship had changed and that he was beginning a relationship with Celia. And initially, nobody knew about it.
Well, Celia was always there, so I don't know that I knew too much, to be honest with you. I mentioned it to him when he was Lord Mayor a few times, all right, and I was assured, you know, that we were all part of the group, so it wasn't unusual for somebody to be around. And I kept my counsel to myself after that.
My parents and our whole family were hugely saddened by Bertie's marriage breakup. We were all very fond of Miriam, very close to Miriam and the girls.
I just never remember it being a problem, ever. I think something like that is probably difficult for the husband and wife who separated, and that's what it's been concentrated on. As daughters, it was fine. We were comfortable with the situation and we were making it work. But for Mom and Dad, I'm sure it wasn't easy.
I managed, and I spoke to the girls about the situation, and we talked it through, and I suppose we really muddled through together. You know, really, at times when it was difficult, we just sort of keep our heads up.
For this to befall them was not pleasant. Was very sad, really. But dark times for Bertie.
I think it's quite simple and direct what Bertie Ahern is. He's a man who's utterly consumed by politics and by the exercise of power, and he has devoted much of his life to that exercise.
All of Bertie Ahern's life is political. All of the money that went for fundraising in the constituency, that was all to his political benefit, but it was also all to his personal benefit. In Bertie Ahern's life, there is no difference.
The blurring of Bertie Ahern's public and private lives is nowhere more apparent than in St. Luke's. From the late 80s, Luke's would become the heart of his constituency operation, and following his separation, often home.
St. Luke's is made up of two offices on the downstairs, and upstairs is a small kitchen, a bedroom, and a room that we now meet for meetings. I mean, that is the entirety of what St. Luke's is.
I suppose the key matter about St. Luke's is that the people who are involved in buying it are the closest people to Bertie Ahern in terms of the finances behind his political career.
So we thought if we could get a property in the area, that we could actually develop it into constituency organisation headquarters.
And we set about doing that in the late 80s. And we bought a building in Drumcondra and refurbished it. With very little money at the time. It was a big organisation.
St. Luke's was purchased for £56,000 in January 1988, following its claimed a fundraising drive at the Gresham Hotel.
The financial side is a completely separate side of life to the political needs, other than it costs a lot of money to run the operation that we run.
Was it always a conscious decision to keep you out of the financial side?
Yes, because I never wanted to be involved in it.
It's always somebody else who handles the money for him. The idea that Bertie Ahern knew nothing of who was contributing cash to his constituency organisation or how much, beggars belief.
Well, no, I did know where the money came from. I mean, I knew the people that put the money into it.
Well, it's set up as a trust, and the trust was set up with the membership. Some of them are deceased now. That's the legal advice was to structure it that way.
I mean, there was no need for him to be involved, and he wasn't involved.
The person who dealt with the money was always done at one remove.
A lot of the transactions that are associated with St. Luke's eventually become the transactions that do him enormous damage in the context of the Mahon Tribunal.
Hello.
Minister, what do you think the prospects of an election are?
Charlie, I don't know.
In 1989, Bertie Ahern's machine was well-tuned and ready for Charles Haughey's biggest political gamble.
You think you'd get an overall majority?
Well, that's the general objective, yes.
Well, it was fair degree of madness.
I think a lot of people urged the Taoiseach at the time. Senior people within the cabinet went to him and said, now is your time.
A lot of the newspaper were saying this is the greatest government that they've had for a long, long time.
Isn't it a beautiful day?
What does he want an election to achieve for them?
Alan Dukes, Des O'Malley, Dick Spring.
Which is totally unnecessary.
And then people said, sir, why there's no need for an election?
And yet, for the 3 weeks of the election, the papers turned us and said we were the worst crowd that ever came around in the history of the state.
Election 89 was Haughey's fifth attempt to win an overall majority, and it would be his last.
My view on this was that you should go your full term and take your chances.
Well, it's been an historic election. It is 77. Is that far short? Not a success for Mr. Haughey.
I wouldn't have called it.
You called it. You didn't have to. You made a judgment. It was a political judgment, and it backfired.
Absolutely. Well, absolutely right. It was a political judgment.
To stay in power, Fianna Fáil would have to think the unthinkable.
Coalitions in our circumstances, whatever about anywhere else, in our circumstances, coalitions do not work, are not satisfactory.
We'd 77 seats, the PD's at 6 or something, so 77 plus 6 equals 83. It was a no-brainer to me.
Well, I would say in relation to the PDs having a seat at cabinet table level, I would think that's a non-starter.
I suppose it's one of the lessons I've learned in politics. You never say never.
Des O'Malley's PDs had split from Fianna Fáil just a few years before. Now Haughey sent his top dealmakers into action.
I never anticipate the end result of negotiations before I start.
These were the official negotiations, but the real negotiations between the government were done at a different level altogether.
While Albert and Bertie faced the press...
Grand. We're just going back to do a bit more work now.
Charlie and Des cut the real deal behind the scenes.
Both of us were annoyed. Both of us were annoyed because it only required a phone call or a few moments just to tell us. I mean, we weren't surprised. It was the means how we heard about them, which I think was in Morning Ireland.
Well, that's the way Mr. Haughey operated.
Now, I think that Mr. Reynolds didn't forget that to Mr. Haughey.
There is, however, another history to those times. In 1989, large sums were flowing into the pockets of certain senior politicians. The election itself a prompt for what they called political donations.
And it's always been the cloud over Fianna Fáil going right back to that 1989 period, because you have a sequence of events during that pre-election period.
My fear at the time was that money which was aimed at and for the party as a whole was not finding its way into our coffers and may well be finding it into the coffers of individual politicians.
There's a £50,000 goes to Pádraig Flynn, £30,000 comes to Ray Burke from two different sources.
It wasn't known at the time. Nothing was known at the time about political donations. I mean, while the rules weren't written as they are now, and there wasn't ethics in public office, the party found it difficult enough to raise money.
We also had, of course, the very serious issue of the party leaders' fund been pillaged by Charles Haughey, but he was only able to do that because others acquiesced in doing so. Most famously of all, a senior Fianna Fáil figure, as Bertie Ahern referred to him, was signing blank checks. It just so happens, it was him. He was the guy who was signing the blank checks to the benefit of Charles Haughey.
Well, you know, I signed the checks. I was given the book. The leaders' fund, in law, is at the control of the leaders. That wasn't a very wise way to have it, quite frankly. It wasn't well managed. I mean, that's quite obviously what happened.
Years later, Bertie Ahern would reject accusations that he did in fact know about the payment to Flynn, a and strongly deny that he had received similar payments himself. For now, the low-profile Minister for Labour had other ideas about his future.
I mean, really, at different times in your life, you work out what you'd like to be and when you'd like to be. And I suppose in the late 80s, my friend started, you know, seriously thinking that I could get leader.
The word in the street was, where does the Taoiseach live?
If they had the votes, they didn't need to start this.
He said thanks very much for, and I'll sort you out.
Well, as a principal, I was probably wrong to take the money from anybody.
Well, I targeted people who had money. I mean, my job was to fundraise for Fianna Fáil.
And you can see the second episode of Bertie, where he responds to detailed questions about his finances, next Monday night at 25 to 10 here on RTÉ One.
Bertie Ahern entered the Dáil overlooked and underrated, but spent a decade building a formidable political machine.
Bertie Ahern had a way of getting things done.
Into that period, it was really tough.
He would work his way to the top of the party.
Nobody saw themselves as realistically having any chance against Bertie Ahern.
But his rise would be accompanied by unusual financial dealings that would one day bring him down.
It doesn't really square up.
I wasn't giving him cash. I was helping out a friend.
Listen, these were guys I knew.
I was elected by the women of Ireland, Manon Ahern, who instead of rocking the cradle, rocked the system.
I mean, I took it personally for Brian Lennon. For us, it was very devastating, the campaign.
October 1990, and Bertie Ahern is in the fight of his life.
Bertie was director of elections because people knew him and trusted him. I mean, it began with high hopes.
Brian Lennon was running for president and was expected to cruise to victory. After all, Fianna Fáil had always won the race for the park. But then an obscure controversy from the 1980s derailed the campaign.
We had no idea what was going to happen on question and answers.
Did he make a phone call or phone calls to Áras an Uachtaráin?
That never happened. I want to assure you that it never happened.
I was perplexed about why Fine Gael changed so late their speakers.
I was in Áras an Uachtaráin when those phone calls came through, and I know how many there were.
I don't know who they were from.
First, Brian Lennon denied he had made late-night phone calls to the president in 1982. Then, a tape appeared where he said that he had.
Did any phone calls get through to the president straight?
Oh, yeah, I got through to him. I remember talking to him.
We all heard your voice on the tape, so that's the difficulty.
I was sick. Of course, if you had it beforehand, then you would have handled the thing differently.
I'm absolutely certain, on mature recollection at this stage, that I did not ring President Hillary, and I want to put my reputation on the line in that respect.
It was set up as a big conspiracy, and then in lots of ways we walked into that conspiracy.
Sean, it's wider than just the presidency.
Sean,
you've now got the government in problems.
Sean.
Does it matter that presidential candidates tell the truth? If it does, then Fianna Fáil has a problem.
It is a national issue, Mr. O'Malley.
Des O'Malley, who was then the leader of the PDs, went to the Charlie Hoy, and he said, if you don't sack him, we're coming out of government and there will be a general election. I mean, they were quite ruthless and definite about it.
Nobody was shouting at anybody. Charlie told Brian that he was going to have to remove him.
I regret to have to inform the House to advise the President to terminate his appointment as a member of the government.
Do you feel the Progressive Democrats had a role to play in pushing Brian Ahern over the edge?
I think everyone saw what happened in Leinster House today.
I think it's one of the issues that many people in our party would often still feel bad about, that we took the stand we did and the way we did.
A last-minute surge of sympathy for Brian Lennon couldn't salvage a chaotic campaign, nor hold back, perhaps, the tide of history.
We were up against the might of the greatest political party in this country, and we beat them.
Fianna Fáil had never lost a presidential election before. The campaign was Bertie Ahern's first serious political reverse.
Bertie Ahern cannot be held responsible for the extraordinary events of the presidential election of 1990. A director of elections can only do so much, and he did as much and more than he could have been asked to do.
But I never felt he was fully behind Brian. I'm sure he pulled out all the stops, but we never felt it or saw the evidence of it.
Haughey's sacrifice of Lennon bought him some time, but his Fianna Fáil PD coalition was rarely far from crisis.
Totally unjustified attempt to put the blame for business scandals onto the government.
The Taoiseach lied in this house last week.
All these questions and all these allegations.
Stop making these false allegations.
Groundless, false allegations.
Please, I put it to you, sir, please. And you should resign from your office.
By now, Bertie Ahern had spent 4 years as Minister for Labour and was due promotion. Haughey, though, preferred to keep his strike fixer in his place.
I suppose the presidential campaign, if we had won it, it would have been a good plus. Into that period, it was difficult, and you just have to get on with it and see what the next opportunity was.
To a certain extent, he has made a career out of being underestimated, and there's a lot to be said for that.
Let's be honest about it, there's always been a great deal of snobbery about Bertie Ahern. People talked about and wrote about the way he spoke.
And my assessment of the needs in this country and at this time.
He was slightly unkempt in those days, and of course he was addicted to his anorak.
Or you never felt he was well turned out. He was always at work and scratching his head and scatty and rushing from one thing to another.
He was always out there in the streets. He was always knocking at the doors. You know, you wondered, did he ever go home? And the truth is that perhaps he didn't. And ended up living pretty well in the company flat over St. Luke's. His marriage had broken down. He hadn't attended to his personal needs. He was living in St. Luke's at that time. And, you know, looking back at his life, you know, a bit of me thinks Bertie would have been perfectly happy living in St. Luke's until this day.
I was living in St. Luke's under difficult circumstances. I mean, 91, 92 were very tough years for me.
I would be very wary of anybody saying that they understand Bertie Ahern, because he has depths, he has cavernous depths that nobody has ever seen.
I mean, you can never, ever know a person fully. I don't think you can ever know any person fully, and that would be the true of Dad. Ask him a question, and he can talk for ages. But right then and there, you will have believed that he'll have spent a good 10 minutes sharing his feelings with you, but yet he hasn't. So it's the way he is. I don't know if he's withholding anything. It's just the way that he is.
And there's no one. No one that I know would be close to him, other than Bertie. When he looks in the mirror, he'd say to himself, can I trust you?
After 4 days and nights of intense negotiations, the two party leaders and their teams looked relieved that it was all over. The fruits of their efforts...
Charles Haughey, of course, thought he had the measure of his young minister. After Bertie Ahern had brokered another deal with the PDs, Haughey described him as the most skillful, the most devious, and the most cunning of them all.
Yeah, I think Bertie would have wished Haughey never said that about him.
Well, I knew straight away that it would be a quotable quote. Didn't realise it lasts so long.
The devious, the most cunning. I think Bertie Ahern had a way of getting things done. You know, look back now retrospectively, that may not appear on the surface, but I'm beginning to think Bertie Ahern always knew what he wanted to achieve.
And now you want to know when you're going to get your telephones.
But others also had ambition. Through the 80s, another minister had been attracting attention.
In 1981, we will install up to 80,000 telephones. In 1982, we will install 100,000 telephones.
Whenever Haughey eventually decided to go, Albert Reynolds would be in the race.
Albert had been a very successful minister. He would have seen himself, and many others would have seen him, as the clear favourite. Party like a winner.
I can succeed. We will succeed. And Fianna Fáil will succeed.
By the autumn of 91, Reynolds was at finance and growing impatient for the top job.
I have a responsibility, a special responsibility as Minister for Finance, to say what I believe is right.
In November, he challenged Haughey head on.
There comes a time when you have to say enough is enough in Paula Hall.
What Albert is doing now is so wrong.
In 1982, I supported the leader. In 1983, I supported the leader. In 1991, I'll support the leader.
No matter what side of the fence you're on, the parliamentary party are making decisions in there. They're acting.
Motion was defeated. That was no problem. He defeated him, Mr. High. No. The most significant thing about that was two members of the cabinet, Albert Reynolds and Padraig Flynn, and three junior ministers walked out of the government.
Albert Reynolds today began the lonely task of contemplating an uncertain political future.
But then they were outside. And Albert had shown a lot of political courage.
Are you going to be the next Minister for Finance? Would you like that job?
Very well, but not tonight, Steve. Now I'm going to go partner with the Dublin.
The welcome is Bertie Ahern.
When he became Minister for Finance, you know, we were bowled over and enormously proud of him.
I can't help noticing, I don't know whether the folks here notice, but the haircut is splendid. The cut of the suit, look at this tie. I mean, God, that's a like splendid tie.
Where's the anorak?
The anorak, yeah.
I remember we had a chat about this. It's God, like, you know, that bloody anorak, you know, it's terrible, you know, it's got to go. You know, it's definitely got to go. So I remember we had a chat with him, and he was a bit nonplussed about this. He said, what's wrong with it? He said, you know, that's not an anorak, he said, you know, that's a car coat. And I said, it's an anorak, you know, it's got to go.
As 1992 began, Bertie Ahern's fortunes had been transformed. He was made Minister for Finance and seen as Haughey's favoured successor. But there was one personal issue that could yet stand in his way.
What about divorce, for instance? I mean, how do you feel about it?
Well, there's great difference. I'm somebody who's had my own difficulties and I've had those for a number of years and I would still have them. So I would feel...
You're talking about your own personal...
My own domestic difficulties. Yeah. So I
think it was brought into the public domain by himself on that particular night.
There are huge difficulties in this country.
There's no point in not saying it because I knew people had been, you know, tracking around and trying to find a big story on it. It's not a great story at that time.
It was the proper thing to do. But at the time, everyone, including myself, said, geez, where's this man gone?
I thought that perhaps the fact that Bertie's marriage had broken down could preclude him from a leadership role in the future. Maybe I'm being a bit conservative, but I feared that it just might be.
And the leadership question was put to the test within days.
No, the situation at that time was that I had a job to do. There was a decision taken in Cabinet.
Statements made by Senator Sean Doherty are absolutely false.
I do feel that I was let down by the fact that people knew. Anybody else that says otherwise is not telling the truth.
Another decade-old controversy, this time over tap phone calls, re-emerged. And in January 92, Haughey was finally forced to go.
He'd been there so long, it seemed to me that he was never going to go. So it's like some sort of a death you'd expect, but it's still a surprise when it actually happens.
When Haughey stepped down then, Albert assumed he was going to be the leader. A group of the existing cabinet and junior ministers all wanted anyone but Albert.
And clearly they encouraged him to run.
The most senior people in the party hierarchy at that stage, probably 80% of them wanted me to run.
It has to be said that some of those deputies had been close to the Haughey regime and feared for their prospects and their jobs if Albert Reynolds took over.
As they knew, their goose was cooked. if Albert was going to become the leader in Taoiseach.
And I think Bertie Ahern weighed up his options at that stage.
Did you run or not in 1982?
No, I didn't. I mean, listen,
Did you canvass? Did you count votes, count heads?
Colleagues of mine counted heads. Yeah, sure they did. Sure they did.
We looked at running for the leadership in 1992, and the truth of the matter is, we were in front. We were at best six ahead, at worst four ahead. So from our point of view, we definitely could have won.
In 1992, he wouldn't have won under any circumstances.
His difficulty, it seemed to me, was that he was too closely associated with the Haughey group. The general feeling amongst a lot of TDs, God, we need a break. We need a break from that.
Well, nobody would have beaten Albert. He was unstoppable.
Bertie Ahern was being pushed to run, but he held off from declaring his hand.
Well, I haven't been involved in any of the discussions, and I haven't had really had much chance to talk to my colleagues.
If he can avoid making the decision, he'll avoid making the decision.
The preparation of the budget is also a very important thing, and there's one person in the country has got that responsibility, and that's me, so I have to finish that job.
People said I was dithering in headlines of the paper, I was dithering when I was trying to get dither through me budget.
But on budget day, Ahern's weak spot was clear to all, as he posed for the traditional family photograph without his wife.
I walked out and there was literally like 30 photographers, and I was just, you can probably tell in the footage, I was just so surprised. But we were completely stunned. I mean, I can't even describe, I just remember being blinded.
Certainly Albert and his closest allies had a certain fear of Bertie, because they made certain comments which we did not like and which still rankle to this day.
The word in the street was, where does the Taoiseach live, and the people of Ireland ought to know where he lives.
There was a feeling, certainly, that people around the Tipperary area, maybe, in particular, were very worried about Bertie's morals at the time.
What I said was a standalone, simple thing about Albert Reynolds' house and his family, and that I said that you couldn't go into a nicer home.
If they had the votes, they didn't need to start this. They knew I was separated. They knew I was living in St. Luke's. I mean, they knew a whole lot of things, you know, that weren't in the public domain.
There have been rumours, you know, some very nasty rumours.
It just wasn't necessary.
It's an unusual thing to say that you admire someone's family.
No, it was just a straightforward comment at the time. Somebody who was going in and out of his house, that was all.
The only people I ever heard comment about his family situation were his opponents in Fianna Fáil.
Ireland is a small place. The surrounds of Leinster House is a small place. When you go in and you say something nasty about someone, they're going to hear it back. I heard it back. I know who said what.
Motion carried. I declare Deputy Albert Reynolds to have been nominated for appointment by the President as Taoiseach.
Bertie was smart enough to know that he wasn't going to beat Albert, so he didn't go ahead, and he wouldn't have won.
And I mean, I remember Albert saying, well, to me, I'm not going to stay very long anyway.
Bertie knew all those erstwhile people who were supporting him would have gladly shot him the next day, because he let them down. They were absolutely furious with them.
People were annoyed at me, there was no doubt about that. I mean, it was a bit cold of a place for a while for me.
His decision not to run in the short term marginally damaged him within the parliamentary party. Certain people might have felt marginalised by his decision.
And they knew what was going to happen to them, and it did.
I propose to assign the Department of Social Welfare Charlie McCreevy, Department of Labour, Brian Cowan, Department of Justice, Padraig Flynn.
The very first morning I went to work with Albert Reynolds, I had to wait to see him. He was busy. He was busy firing 17 ministers, 8 senior ministers, 9 juniors. It took him just over 15 minutes to fire each one separately.
I said to him, congratulations, you're elected. And the first thing he said to me was, he says, yeah, I won't be reappointing you as Chief Whip. I was shocked.
I was the last brought in, which gave me
hope maybe I was going to be kept. He was standing at a table in his office and he was having a cup of tea and a sandwich. He said, I don't need you in cabinet, and some of his sandwich came out of his mouth. And I said, I want to know why. Ah, don't give me that old guff, more sandwich, and you're going and that's that.
He said to me when he came in, I could have done with a revolving door here, he said, to deal with all of these guys.
I'm sure this is probably the first time that we have seen 8 members of a government that have been sacked in the course of a cabinet reshuffle.
Department of Finance, Bertie Ahern.
Well, there were a lot of people very unhappy. I think I made a wise decision that night, just got out of the place.
It's clear that the Taoiseach went for an energy-driven cabinet.
I think Des O'Malley said to him, you'll never get away with it. It was a risk, and a fairly substantial risk.
I want to lead an administration in which nobody would feel left out.
The minister simply looked stunned. Nobody had ever seen a bloodletting like this before.
The seeds of Albert Reynolds' own downfall were perhaps partially contained within those wholesale changes that he made, which came back to haunt him.
You watch things and you watch reactions and you plan your own style of things.
Bertie Ahern had survived Reynolds' purge unscathed, at the price of shelving his own ambitions for now. In the heat of the campaign, his private life had been used against him. Those around him swore it wouldn't happen again.
It did send a chill down our spines. And subsequently, a few of us said, you know, we better get on with this and see, you know, you've got to get a residence, you know. People of Ireland want to know if you ever been a Taoiseach, they want to know where you live and where you sleep at night.
Don't forget, they made a decision a long, long time back that they were going to get their man across the line. Nobody was going to stand in that way, regardless of what happened.
30 seconds.
The government suspended the pound from the European monetary system tonight after failing to stop it falling through the floor of the exchange rate mechanism.
It was horrendous. Interest rates were skyrocketing.
I remember every day of it, and that was tough. It was really tough.
The pound is extremely weak because foreign investors are taking their money out of the country.
Crisis started in September. We became collateral damage to what happened in the UK.
The pound could come under pressure too.
You're worried about speculators, you're worried about hits against the Irish pound.
All the evil people of the world were out to get our little currency.
One morning, somebody in Tokyo hit a 50 million debt against the Irish pound. Extraordinary.
Bertie was like Cúchulainn, tied to the rock of the Irish pound, and everybody else attacking him.
You going to devalue?
Yes, sir.
Are you going to devalue funds?
After that.
The central bank increased its overnight lending rate to 100% today. Another increase in interest rates would seriously damage the economy.
It went up 3% that day. I got the privilege of announcing it on Morning Ireland. David Hanley hit the microphone.
The pressure on the currency led to a huge rise in interest rates.
The shorter term interest rates at one stage, I think, came to 24 or 25%.
And really, the whole future of the country appeared to be in jeopardy.
I remember the combined wisdom saying that ultimately you're going to have to devalue. The trick is never to blink, never make it look as if you will.
Well, our position is that we do not favour devaluation in any respect.
And when you do it big enough that the Irish economy will bounce back.
Good evening. Europe's currencies are likely to come under more pressure on the money markets tomorrow after Ireland was forced to devalue its currency, the pund, by 10%.
If it was seen to be a managed devaluation, that was quite different from something that was going to be forced on you. And in fact, after we devalued, huge international support came in for the Irish pound.
This should remove the threat of another rise in retail bank and mortgage rates.
But a great education, and ultimately when we did devalue, probably the handling of that was one of my best decisions.
For four long months, Bertie Ahern had resisted pressure on the pound before bowing to the inevitable in early 1993. By then, Albert Reynolds' government had switched partners.
There was never going to be any settling of the rift between Albert and Des O'Malley. After all, Albert had made it clear from the very beginning that he believed the Fianna Fáil PD pact was a temporary little arrangement.
In October 92, tensions between the two men came to a head during an inquiry into the beef industry.
Desi Dooley pulled the plug and we were catapulted into a quite disastrous election.
Yeah, the race is on, Charlie. We want to get at them before they get at us.
The campaign was held in the dead of winter. The weather was appalling. The outgoing government was very unpopular.
That's what the people want, and they're very angry.
Right,
and I'm one of them.
From day one, it was just a damage limitation exercise.
The atmosphere is very good out there. I've been finding that on the ground.
Okay. You want to propaganda.
The only question was how many seats Fianna Fáil were going to lose.
It was abundantly clear the Labour Party were going to do exceptionally well.
It was just one bit of good news after another. You really knew just from the feeling in the air that something big was happening.
Well, this is an historic election. The tide is going out for both Fianna Fáil and Fine Gael. The Labour Party, it's a huge gain for them. They'll double their seats.
9 seats lost. The fatality rate is massive. Everybody agreed, including myself, that was the end of Albert as Taoiseach. But Albert, a wily old dealer, he had the measure of Labour.
It was never his wish or desire to go into government with Fianna Fáil, and particularly to go into government with Albert Reynolds.
He knew they could and they would strike a hard bargain, but he also knew he could reach these guys.
Dick Spring, against his will and against, I think, his better judgment, was instrumental in putting him back in.
It was an amazing Volfast. We were beaten badly, and up rode Dick on his white horse and committed to government with us. And here we were back in government with the biggest majority of all time.
Nice. That isn't it, really.
But the new Fianna Fáil Labour coalition was a shotgun marriage with an uncertain future.
I felt things would quickly go sour, which they did.
The chemistry between Albert and Dick never really worked. Dick was notoriously touchy, took offence very easily. And Albert, God knows, was no diplomat.
No.
Bertie, I think, would have seen it as his role in those days to be the sort of emollient figure. We almost immediately, instinctively saw him as the, you know, the extra Labour minister.
Those of us who have jobs must put the need to create jobs above our personal interests.
As Minister for Finance, Bertie Ahern showed both ability and a social conscience. He was capable, though, of saying one thing and then doing another.
Extraordinary things happened when Bertie Ahern was Minister for Finance. He introduced a tax amnesty in 1993 to everybody's amazement.
The amnesty was to deal with tax dodgers and their so-called hot money. And I recall nobody, apart from Albert at the time, seemed to be in favour of it.
On the morning that that government decision was taken, Bertie made it clear to us that there was no way he would be promoting or supporting a tax amnesty. He was quite adamant and very strong about it.
I didn't like the idea of the tax amnesty, even though it was, I had many arguments and debates about it.
So we were all completely shocked when later in the day a tax amnesty was announced.
But why then did you agree to it in Cabinet?
Oh, well, what happened was I argued in the Cabinet, and I always remember some of my colleagues say, once off and you can close the door. And I, myself as Minister of Finance, were closing a whole lot of the loopholes.
Once having corrected the system, then I think you have to have a merciless view on this.
So they said, listen, give people a break and do it. I didn't like it.
Suddenly, just at a time when Fianna Fáil was going around and trying to clear its unsubstantial debts, Bertie Ahern introduces a tax amnesty, one that nobody thought was necessary.
I'm not sure if the tax amnesty suited Fianna Fáil particularly more than anybody else. Fianna Fáil would know more about that than I would. It certainly suited the mood among the movers and shakers in the country at the time. It was a contribution to a culture that still hasn't been completely rooted out.
I think people know my view for 20 years, and it would actually give me the greatest of pleasure watching non-compliant taxpayers going to jail. That's the kind of person I am.
He's a minister at the time who now, 15 years later, can't show he was actually tax compliant at the time.
Money would dominate the next phase of Bertie Ahern's career. Under his direction, huge amounts would pour into party coffers, while bundles of cash worth at least twice his salary would be lodged to bank accounts under his control. The money trail begins in early 1993 when the Minister for Finance takes on an additional job.
Albert had made me treasurer. I was vice president, and then he made me treasurer. We owed a fortune, and we had a whole lot of unpaid bills, and we had to get the finances right.
Bertie thought we needed to clear the debt now, and he wanted to bring in a fundraiser to work exclusively on that, and he brought in Des Richardson, whom I hadn't known at that time or had never met, but obviously he was well known to Bertie Ahern.
Des Richardson is a key person in all of this. Their relationship goes back a long way.
There's very few people can pull up in their car, walk straight into Drumcondra without an appointment and walk into his office. There's a handful of people who do that. Des Richardson is one of them.
Back in February 93, March 93, I came into Fianna Fáil to have a look at the financial situation at Bertie's request. And we had a debt of £3.5 million Irish pounds. And on top of that, every Monday morning, we had another £8,000 interest building.
Des wouldn't have been an activist in the party as such, so he came in on a professional basis, paid a professional fee. He operated from a room in the Berkeley Court Hotel.
Why Des Richardson, though? I mean, he wasn't a professional fundraiser.
He wasn't, but he was a guy I knew very well, an efficient guy who was well able to talk and engage with people.
In the 80s, Bertie Ahern had taken control of Fianna Fáil in Dublin Central. Now he had his own man at the centre of the entire party's finances.
Des Richardson, he was never a member of the party, never a member of a common, even though he was for a period the main fundraiser for Fianna Fáil, as well as the main fundraiser for Bertie Ahern's constituency operation.
Is it fair enough to say that your primary loyalty was to Bertie Ahern rather than to the party?
Primarily, yes. As I said, I'm passionate about politics and I love Fianna Fáil, and I've worked with Fianna Fáil for many years, but primarily through Bertie Ahern, yeah.
Mr. Richardson engaged in a feverish process of clearing the party's debt with the different types of fundraisers.
His legacy, I suppose, would be the Galway Races tent and all these big flashy events.
I was always very careful and advised by Bertie Ahern when it came into fundraising just to be careful on that front.
Is it fair to say that the people you were targeting were very wealthy businessmen in this country?
Well, I targeted people who had money. I mean, my job was to fundraise for Fianna Fáil. They came from different backgrounds, accountants, doctors, builders, developers, yeah. If I thought he had money, I'd go and talk to him.
He'd set up events in the private homes of very wealthy individuals, some of whom benefited subsequently from decisions made by the Minister for Finance.
Against all the advice of his own officials, he went and he brought in legislation which was to the benefit of an individual called Ken Rowan, who was also involved in providing consultancy fees to Des Richardson, Bertie Ahern's money man.
The value of furnishings and artworks in his house, he was allowed to write them off against his tax bill, and it was quite a significant figure, in excess of £1 million.
Special tax legislation, retrospective for 12 years, absolutely unheard of.
I worked for Ken Rowan, and I did attend a dinner that Ken hosted on behalf of Fianna Fáil.
Were you aware then that he was lobbying the department for a special tax break?
At the time, no. Yeah, but that's his entitlement. It doesn't mean he's going to get it. and he wouldn't get it if he didn't have a good case. I'm not sure what the case was at the time.
But some people would argue the case was that he was giving money to Fianna Fáil.
Lots of people give money to Fianna Fáil and get nothing in return.
Ken Rowan states that he was part of a wider lobbying effort by conservation societies for the tax break. He appears, though, to have been the sole beneficiary, at least until 2004, and has been named in the Dáil as a significant donor to Fianna Fáil. Bertie Ahern maintains that the measure was designed to keep important artworks in the country and denies any link between political donations and changes to the tax system. Within a few years, Fianna Fáil's multi-million pound debt would be substantially reduced. Des Richardson's appeal to wealthy businessmen an evident success.
Can you understand the scepticism of maybe ordinary people that if someone's giving large amounts of money to a political party, they want something in return?
No. People help Fianna Fáil because they like Fianna Fáil, and that's their bottom line.
But why do they like Fianna Fáil?
Well, they want to see Fianna Fáil in power.
Why do they want to see Fianna Fáil in power?
Well, because maybe under Fianna Fáil they will have more success.
So Richardson was very important in raising very, very large amounts of money. But not only that, he also happened to be somebody that we know now was involved in raising personal funds for Mr. Ahern.
In a two-year period in the mid-90s, more than £160,000 would be lodged or relodged to a network of bank accounts under Bertie Ahern's control. This was on top of his salary, and most of it was cash.
Quite clearly, he was a man who was putting lots of money away, and he was a man who was taking money in appropriate circumstances, benefiting from his political position personally.
If Bertie was to do all these things again, he wouldn't have done them, I'm sure. All I know is Bertie invariably makes things quite complicated and confused.
The main thing to remember about all of this stuff is that if I wasn't separated, I wouldn't have been staying in St. Luke's in an apartment. I wouldn't have been trying to buy another house. I wouldn't have been cashing my checks. Our friends wouldn't have been giving me money. So all three of the issues that created so much problem to me were all directly related to the fact that I was separated.
In late 1993, the first in a series of large cash payments to Bertie Ahern was arranged. His friends believed he faced a large legal bill arising from his separation proceedings from his wife, Miriam.
We chose six or seven or eight people that we would approach looking for some money to help Bertie pay off that debt. You know, as far as I was aware, he was in hard times at that time.
Des said, look, can you come in and see me? I went in to see him in the Berkeley court and asked me would I be interested in getting involved. I said I would without even thinking twice about it. I told him, look, tell me what you want, when you want it, how you need it, and I'll take care of everything else.
Eventually, in December 93, we had, I think, £22,500, and he then said he would accepted condition that it'd be repaid in due course. And we said, of course, yes to that. Now, the people who paid the money didn't really want it back.
Was it embarrassing for you taking that money at that time?
I think, listen, these were guys I knew. I think they would all admit none of them, this was not big for the money to them in any way. They wanted to help out.
He had money. The guy wasn't broke. The guy wasn't destitute. Well, he could have said, no, I don't want this. This isn't something you should give to me. He took it.
Did it ever cross your mind that there was something strange about giving a senior politician, he was finance minister, cash?
No, because it wasn't cash. I wasn't giving him cash. I was helping out a friend. He was finance minister. He was this and he was that. But at the end of the day, he was a friend who was basically in trouble.
But not everyone who contributed to the first dig out considered themselves a friend of Bertie Ahern. One donor, Porrig O'Connor, has stated that his company gave Des Richardson £5,000 for the local party and not for Ahern personally.
Porrig O'Connor was very helpful to me and a person was a good friend. That to me and to my dying day was a personal donation to me.
It's conceivable that you could have taken money raised for the local party from Porrig O'Connor and just given it to Bertie without Porrig O'Connor knowing.
No, I didn't need to do that. This was, as you said, a dig out to help Bertie Ahern on a one-off situation. Now, I went to friends of Bertie Ahern. They all said yes, and that's what happened. But to make the point, if I wanted to raise £100,000 for Bertie Ahern, I could have done that in 1 week.
The effect of what Des Richardson did is created this very close link between money that was raised for Fianna Fáil and money that was given to Bertie Ahern.
Did you ever take money intended for the party for yourself personally?
Never. I never money collected in my constituency, or money collected, you know, for election campaigns, or money collected for the party.
But the strangest aspect of the first dig out is that Bertie Ahern apparently didn't need the money. Bank records show that when he accepted the cash, he had already taken out a loan to clear his legal bills, and he would later claim that in December 93, he had cash savings of more than £50,000.
At the time, he had a job where he was earning £64,000 a year, and he had £54,000 in a safe, so it doesn't really square up.
Why then would his friends think Bertie Ahern was hard up?
This event, this dig out did happen. There have been question marks over it. It did happen. And I was central to it.
What do you say?
I say, well, it's true. And they don't believe us. That's their hard luck.
I accept this, that if I wasn't separated in the first place, I would have been lodging me checks monthly, and then I couldn't have saved them. And I accept it if I wasn't separated, that I would have never had mates giving me money. I accept that. Would I have been better off not taking this? It would have been far better off now. Of course I would have.
We urge everyone to approach this new situation with energy, determination, and patience.
August 1994. The Provisional IRA suspend their long war after months of behind-the-scenes talks with Taoiseach Albert Reynolds.
We won the war.
You must remember, Albert brought about the ceasefire. Nobody but Albert Reynolds would be able to do that.
Charlie couldn't do it because he had too much baggage. Garrett didn't want to talk to them. John Bruton wouldn't be seen dead with the problem.
Today is only a beginning. It's the end of an era of 25 years of arms conflict and violence. Clearly, the arms conflict is over.
Bertie stayed clear of the whole Northern thing. What was going on in the back of his mind about is another thing. There was always this distance between Albert and Bertie. Bertie kept himself to himself.
Bertie Ahern has never surrounded himself with close pals in cabinet or socialised with people in cabinet.
Early on, I began to sense this tension between the pair of them. I suppose it was basically that there was only two people there vying for the leadership all along, and that was Albert and Bertie. They weren't going to be best friends.
While Bertie Ahern bided his time, more money was flowing into accounts under his control. On October the 11th, 1994, he walked into an AIB branch and lodged another large cash sum. So where did this money come from?
It was still pretty etched in our mind in relation to the comments that had been made by fellow party members, I'd have to say. And I think it was decided that, you know, something should be done.
Politically, it was thought Bertie Ahern needed to get out of St. Luke's and acquire an address of his own. His partner, Celia Larkin, began to look for a suitable house. Meanwhile, in September 1994, a group of friends met in the Beaumont House pub, owned and run by a man called Dermot Carew.
Dermot Carew, Paddy Riley and Barry English, you know, we basically put a few bob together and gave it to him in the prospect that he might get a house or he might get a home, right?
Conversation took place up in Beaumont House. It came up about, you know, something should be done to sort things out and whatever. Because of his situation of going through a divorce.
They spontaneously decided that they would have a collection for him and give him some money that he could put towards purchasing a house.
I'd have a very simple thing. I committed to being part of it that night. You know, when I decided to do it, I would just do it, and that's it, so.
Curiously, I suppose, just like the previous group in December 1993, they also decided that it should be cash. All the cash contributions left no trace. There is no money trail to show where this cash came from.
I give £5,000 to Dermot Carew within a day or 2 days of agreeing to give the money.
So this money was given to Mr. Ahern in an envelope in the same pub a few days afterwards. Did Bertie ever acknowledge?
He did. He said thanks very much for, and I'll sort you out.
Would you have called yourself a close personal friend of him at that stage?
Close, absolutely not, no. You know, close, I could have met him 7, 8, 9, 10 times. You know, you don't count.
I was around in Drumcondra for a long, long time. But there was one particular name, funny enough, you know, that I'd never heard of before. And he was only a young guy at the time, would have been Barry English.
You were 28 years old. You'd only met Bertie Ahern several occasions. Yeah. Yet you coughed up £5,000 without, it seems, thinking about it too much. People find that difficult to believe.
Yeah. Yeah, the band, as I say, they're 2 steps, 3 steps, 4 steps removed from the facts. So anything from the outside can look different or strange in any type of life.
Why would Barry English give you £5,000 when he didn't really know you?
Well, Dermot Carew did, and Joe Burke did, and Barry had come back from abroad, and he had joined up with our crew, and he knew what the guys were doing, and he, I think, wanted to make a contribution.
I work in the construction industry. My clients are developers and the like, and I don't think it does me any harm to be known publicly as a friend of Bertie Ahern's, because they say, you know, this guy has helped the country, has helped us to become a nation that we are, so.
A man who wants to come back to Ireland, set up as a businessman, gives £5,000 to a politician. As a principle, it's wrong.
Well, as a principle, I was probably wrong to take the money from anybody. I mean, you know, but if I ever thought and that I was going to be answerable for all of these things years later and that there was any great significance of them, of course you wouldn't do them at all.
Did you feel at the time you were doing something wrong?
No. And you know why? I didn't give it to a politician, and I didn't give it to the Minister of Finance. I gave it to a friend, a personal friend, long-standing friend.
The kindness of friends is the explanation given for the Dublin digouts. But what motivation lay behind the final lump of cash that Bertie Ahern admits receiving in 1994? The city of Manchester plays a recurring, though low-profile, part in Bertie Ahern's finances. The city is home to a vibrant Irish community from which he built another network of business contacts.
When he was Minister for Finance, he went to a function in Manchester and took 8,000 sterling from a whip-around from the people who were there.
Manchester dinner was very simple. I had been over to a lot of those kind of dinners for a number of years, and I'd gone along their Manchester group of Irish business people, and I would regularly call in and do a dinner with them. I probably had done it for a number of years, down to the Manchester Irish Club, maybe in Tim Kilroe's hotel. On that night, and on the only night of all the ones I'd ever done, wherever I'd done them, Tim Kilroe and others decided to give me a financial donation. And they did.
Bertie Ahern gets a lot of money from a lot of people. It all seems something of a mystery to him as to why it happens, but it's not a mystery. He's a politician. He's a highly influential politician.
That's how I got it and where I got it. Now, obviously, I wish I didn't, but that's how it was. I appreciated it at the time, and I lodged it, and that was it.
According to Ahern then, the October 94 lodgement was made up of Irish pounds from the Beaumont House digout and some sterling from the Manchester whip round. There is an unusual coincidence though with the exact figure lodged.
A problem with the lodgement is that the overall amount lodged on the day equates to £25,000 sterling exactly when you use one of the exchange rates in operation on the day and you subtract the £5 commission.
Bank records also show that the AIB branch normally took in a small amount of sterling each day. On that day, though, the branch received around £25,000 more sterling than usual. Another coincidence.
Bank records would indicate that somebody came in there on that day and put £25,000 sterling into the branch, which would indicate that there was no dig out. Or if there was a dig out, the dig out money went somewhere else. And we don't know at all where this £25,000 sterling came from.
Well, it did happen. I mean, the first one happened, it did happen, and I got the money, and I remember the night I got the money, and I remember the night I got the money in Manchester. And it's easy enough for me to remember it, because in 31 years in politics, I think it was only the 3 times I ever got money.
the money that I handed over and that I said that I handed over, Bertie said he lodged it. Whether Bertie used that as a lodgement, I wasn't at the counter watching it going into the bank.
The simplest explanation for all of that is that someone was giving you large amounts of sterling.
Yes, yes. I mean, and that has been the, I think, the view that I was. Well, the fact is I wasn't.
On the day Bertie Ahern lodged the money, the Reynolds Spring government was coming apart at the seams.
It was an extraordinary period. And the rumours that went around were crazy.
For weeks, a row had been brewing over what seemed a routine legal appointment.
There were a series of incidents, really over a kind of a 12-month period. There was the row about the publication of the Beef Tribunal, and eventually the Harry Whelan row brought the whole thing to a head.
Whelan was the Attorney General at the time. Reynolds had promised him promotion to the top job in the High Court, but without the approval of Dick Spring.
In Albert Reynolds' mind, and in a phrase he always used, my word is my bond, I have given my word to Harry Whelan, he's got the job.
Taoiseach seems that he won't back off, Tony. Is it a resignation issue?
Dick finally said, OK, Harry gets the job.
And then suddenly, the Brendan Smith affair broke.
This is the story of a Catholic priest who's also a paedophile.
It became clear that the Attorney General's office, for whatever reason, had been sitting on the extradition of Father Brendan Smith.
The next thing I knew, Dick Spring's secretary was saying to me, message for Albert. The priest changes everything. The deal is off.
So began one of the most bizarre weeks in Irish politics.
Let's put it like this, it was an absolute fiasco from beginning to end.
Well, it seemed to be just total chaos.
First thing is Labour walk out of the cabinet room because Harry's being appointed.
Albert is going to stick to his word, and Harry himself should have seen what was happening, but Mr. Whelan, a fine, honourable man, he hadn't got a political brain in his head, unfortunately.
But it was high drama.
I have this opportunity of consulting my colleagues and taking their views.
This thing is coming apart at the seams. It's just all falling apart.
Albert was calling meetings at fairly at fairly frequent intervals.
Brian, you better see Howland. You better see Harry. You know, and it just went around and round and round.
I think we started running things by committee. It only led to more confusion. The thing was complicated enough.
Privately, they've been saying they believe this government is on the verge of collapse.
The final 2 days were just a blur.
You not think we're facing an election?
I'll be answering questions in the Dáil about the whole episode on Tuesday.
The next thing Albert has to say, I'm sorry that I appointed Harry.
I genuinely regret that. And any inadvertent offence caused to the Taoiseach and his Labour Party colleagues.
I'll be going back to my office very shortly.
On foot of it, however, Dick then agrees, in writing, I will lead my Labour ministers back into government.
I had a very uneasy feeling about it.
The following morning, the two government parties entered the Dáil, ready to face down a vote of no confidence.
That was fine, and suddenly Dick said, oh, hold on, you never told us about the Duggan affair.
The Duggan case was similar to that of Father Brendan Smith. Albert Reynolds had argued that Smith's case had been delayed because it was the first of its kind. Now, Dick Spring found out there had been a precedent.
Having made this discovery, I went with some of my colleagues to meet the Taoiseach shortly before noon today.
Dick steps in.
I outlined to the Taoiseach what I discovered.
Dick steps out.
And the implications of that discovery.
Dick steps in again.
Neither I nor any of my colleagues can vote confidence in the government.
Dick steps out again, only this time there was no stepping back.
All of my Labour colleagues in Cabinet will resign from their offices before this vote is taken.
The atmosphere was feral. Pater Abbott had, you know, that famous comment about, you know, something that would shake the foundations of the state.
Is there another document that ought to be before this House that will rock the foundations of
the deputy is now anticipating the debate, which...
No need to raise your voice.
I mean, there was talk of paedophile rings, paedophile circles, cabinet ministers were in disarray.
If you can give me any steer, any direction, any help...
He could see what was happening and he could see the thing slipping from his fingers.
And I'm not going to lead off this debate until I'm in a position to give the full facts to this House.
We were still on the government side, although without power. And you could feel power ebbing across the floor to the opposition.
Excuse me.
Albert Reynolds should resign immediately.
Albert Reynolds is as decent and as straight a man tonight as he was this morning or yesterday. And let me explain.
There's all kinds of allegations to be made, but the end of the day was that we were turfed out of government.
I never recall Bertie particularly involving himself. I think he just stood back and let it happen.
For 2 days in the Dáil, Bertie Ahern had sat loyally but quietly at Reynolds' side. He'd remained quiet even when past documents intended to help the Taoiseach answer questions on the Smith case.
I know that Bertie Ahern was sitting beside Albert Reynolds and that he did have the information and didn't pass it on. I have no idea what his motivation was.
Remember what happened? I was given a file of a whole lot of papers. And I think I was given them when I was in the chamber, but I certainly wasn't withholding anything. I was doing my best to protect them.
He probably just held on to it until Albert sat down. But many supporters of Albert saw something sinister in that.
Did you feel as a strong supporter of Albert Reynolds that Bertie Ahern was really fully part of the effort to keep that thing going?
No, so I mean, I suppose the honest answer is no. I certainly would have liked to have him much more involved. I didn't see him up front in the way that you would expect to happen in a circumstances like that.
I wish to announce to the Dáil that I intend, following this statement, to go to Áras an Uachtaráin to tender my resignation as Taoiseach and that of my ministers to the President.
Albert's last words to the Dáil: you get over, you cross over the big hurdles, it's when you get to the small ones that you get yourself tripped up.
In November 94, Albert Reynolds resigned as Taoiseach after a roller coaster 2.5 years in office. But could he cling on as leader of Fianna Fáil? Once before, Bertie Ahern had held back from a challenge. This time, he went for the kill.
It was blitzkrieg, and that has always been the hallmark of Bertie's campaign.
Good evening, Minister. Can I ask you, are you going to be a candidate for the Fianna Fáil leadership?
Yes, the Taoiseach is not yet. Handed in his resignation.
I think early on, Maura Geoghegan Quinn reckoned that she had a chance of becoming leader.
But at this stage, the parliamentary party had got the smell of Bertie, the whiff of Bertie, the whiff of power to come.
I'm extremely confident and very happy.
And you're not pulling out of the race? No?
Absolutely not.
We knew the night before, Maura and I and a few others, that she wasn't going to win. She wasn't going to come win a mile of Bertie.
Nobody saw themselves as realistically having any chance against Bertie Ahern, so they made a virtue of necessity and roared in with the winner.
It became clear there wouldn't be a need for a ballot box as Maura Geoghegan Quinn announced she was pulling out of the race.
I was delighted. I mean, the opportunity of leading the party, having had gone through the speculation of wanting to be leader previously, you take the opportunity. You're lucky to get it. So, you know, you're sometimes in the right place at the right time.
He was catapulted into it then, I suppose you could say, in 94, and he wasn't ready. I suppose he hadn't, as I say, his marriage had broken down.
I am separated from my wife, Miriam. We now live apart, and I'm glad of the understanding of the party and my colleagues that they understood that matter.
I was delighted for him. I mean, he really deserved the job he was getting. But at the time, and still now, I feel that our marital split was really nothing to do with anybody else and it shouldn't have been used against him.
There was an anxiety for unity.
We've gone through 25 years of fighting, arguing, bickering, heaves, counter-heaves, and somebody had to stop that, and I'm glad today that we put an end to it.
You knew straight away this was going to be a tough challenge, because there was absolutely no guarantee that Fianna Fáil would be back in government.
When the dust had settled, Bertie Ahern was left, at 43, the youngest ever leader of Fianna Fáil.
I saw pictures on the news of you with your mother. Now, what did she say to you? Can you confide in us what she said?
Well, I think she was just pleased. She's always worrying about me and praying for me and gives out to me. And her advice was, make sure you do everything honest, and I'll take her advice.
I thought that was a done deal.
He was shattered, emotionally, politically.
They're a waffler.
It was obviously quite a weekend in St. Luke's.
It was a deadline. We had to keep going.
Been a fall in that a man of your separated marital status will possibly be.
In 1994, Bertie Ahern was swept into the leadership of Fianna Fáil.
He was catapulted into it then, I suppose you could say. He wasn't ready.
But strange financial dealings shadowed his rise to power.
That's his 30,000 for his use in Celia's name.
And his first year in the Taoiseach's office would prove the most turbulent.
It was a very strange start to a government indeed.
A line is in the sand.
I think he knew what needed to be done and he did it.
And he was obviously quite determined to get the deal.
We were into a very difficult period.
Relax.
Isn't that true? Answer the question. Answer the question. Answer the question.
Nobody smoke screening. Perhaps if you stop waffling, we might get some work done. At that time, I used to just think he was an irritable little yet anyway. They're a waffler.
He lost the cool and the mask slipped.
There've been years around here waffling.
I just gave him a bit of me tongue.
It wasn't even what he said, it was his facial expressions. It was really quite vehement.
We did not cause.
I think a lot of people were shocked to see that side of him.
It was the end of a very long week for Bertie Ahern. Following the collapse of Albert Reynolds' government, he'd been trying to strike a coalition deal with Labour that would have made him Taoiseach.
Virtually as soon as Albert resigned, a discussion opened between Bertie and Dick Spring. They had always got on well, and I think there was a kind of a general assumption that it would be possible to put an alternative government together.
Personally, would you work well with Dick Spring?
I think I'd work well with anybody who's interested in trying to operate policies for the benefit of the country.
Quite a few of us felt that it would be a mistake to resume negotiations with Fianna Fáil, and that it would be a terrible mistake to go back in now.
Bertie would have seen Findlay now as a malign influence.
Okay.
Thanks very much.
Do you
mind
me calling you Bertie?
Not at all.
He's a very optimistic individual. I mean, he's not a defeatist kind of person. So again, it would be, right, let's get on with it.
This evening, the two sets of negotiating teams were back around a table at a room in Leinster House. And all the indications are this session will be a long one.
Bertie Ahern had very good relationships with people in the Labour Party. And the assumption was that everything was going fine.
I'll do all I can and my colleagues will to try and achieve a government by Tuesday.
The negotiations got to the point where a programme for government was essentially written. The Labour ministers were going back more or less into the jobs that they had held before.
Finally, we thought we saw the end of the tunnel and that Bertie was to be the Taoiseach. He called me in, I remember, and he said to me, "Now, I'm going to make you Minister for the Environment." And he showed me where he had drawn up his list of cabinet members. So he was all ready.
I remember coming down the steps of government buildings on the Sunday night and saying to him, "You know, you'll probably be Taoiseach by Tuesday." Little did I know by Monday night it would all be gone west.
We woke up on a Monday morning to read Geraldine Kennedy's a very heavy, portentous article. Dick Spring had discovered something. Nobody knew what.
I went into the office and he said to me, "We're never going to be out of trouble with these guys, are we?"
But if Dick Spring had discovered something, Dick Spring was going to cause trouble. And so he did.
The newspaper revealed new details of the Whelehan affair that had forced Reynolds to resign 3 weeks before.
Without going into all the details of it, it held that Fianna Fáil ministers had known more than they had admitted to their Labour Party colleagues that they knew.
Albert was effectively gone, but he was still technically Taoiseach, so we were forced to go to this, would you believe, EU Security Conference in Budapest.
On the Monday morning, Bertie left for Brussels to attend a meeting of finance ministers in Brussels.
Now, Dick was at home, shades of Eamon de Valera and the treaty negotiation. Word came through to us. Labour are threatening to pull out.
Fairly sick, because I thought that was a done deal. It all started going from under me. I remember talking to Celia at some stage, and she said, get back.
How significant is it that the talks on a new government have now been suspended?
Oh, that's significant.
Now, everything started to slide at that moment. I remember Tommy Gorman of RTÉ trying to doorstep Albert and me trying to get away from them. I leading Albert through labyrinthine hotel kitchens. I mean, it was manic stuff.
The day that started with me at about 6 o'clock in the morning, leaving St. Luke's to go to Brussels to be elected Taoiseach the following day or the day after, ended up with me going back to Luke's about 2 a.m. To get that phone call.
Dick Spring rang Bertie Ahern and said, I'm afraid there's really no basis on which we can proceed.
Did you try to argue with him?
No, I didn't.
Bertie said something like, are you sure, Dick? I'm sure we could work this out, etc., etc. So they called it a night.
I think, well, first of all, I had to phone around my some of my friends. I remember trying to wake some of my cabinet colleagues up.
At 3 o'clock, I remember running down the stairs. The phone was ringing. Bertie here, Paddy. I said, yeah, is there something wrong? Yeah, he says, F it, Springer has pulled the plug.
Those sort of events at other times might shock people to the core, but he remained very, very positive all through that.
He was shattered emotionally, politically. It was as if somebody come in and broken all the crockery.
Do you accept now that you won't be able to form a government with Dick Spring, that this, it's all over for you, that you'll have to go into opposition?
I do. Mother, it's looking bad. I don't think he's going to make it.
We were all there ready with our new goonas and ready to go down to the Dáil. My mother at this stage was 86. I can remember at that time her saying, I now won't see him as Taoiseach.
At the last moment, Bertie Ahern's dream of becoming Taoiseach had been snatched away. Dick Spring went back into government, but as part of a new rainbow coalition.
Dick Spring said he wouldn't form a cabinet with Bertie Ahern, and they crossed the floor and joined with Fine Gael.
No matter what happened, I want to go back and get back home.
Making your way in the world today takes everything you've got.
Bad form that the people of Ireland have been robbed of a decent man in Bertie Ahern being the next Taoiseach.
Wouldn't you like to get away?
Yeah, all the strong condo is just a pleasant place to be home to.
Sometimes you wanna go where everybody knows your name.
Bertie is essentially a creature of habit. Always glad you came.
His little place where he has a bit of kind of headspace to walk around and clear his head and think things through.
Drumcondra is his village.
Bertie Ahern returned to Drumcondra to reflect on what might have been. But over the 3 days in which he had glimpsed and lost the Taoiseach's office, even stranger events were happening right here.
A man called Michael Wall came to Ireland that weekend from Manchester and says he brought with him a suitcase full of cash.
Micheál Wall, man of mystery. Micheál Wall came out of nowhere. Nobody had really heard of this guy before he suddenly emerged as Bertie Ahern's landlord.
Micheál Wall was an acquaintance of Bertie Ahern's from Manchester, where he ran a coach company. He lived in this house in the suburbs.
The money that Mick Wall puts in, I mean, Mick Wall is a wealthy person, relatively wealthy. He puts in 30,000 of his money. That's his 30,000.
This guy is not a significant business person who would have been well known in Ireland. And then that he would be the type who would come over and throw 30,000 sterling on Bertie Ahern's desk in his constituency office.
And it was all part of a plan to get Bertie Ahern a house, a plan with which Celia Larkin was also engaged.
Micheál Wall was apparently keen to buy a house in Dublin as a base to launch a new business, but was happy to rent it out to Bertie Ahern in the meantime. Wall was also, apparently, happy to let Celia Larkin choose the house and decorate it.
I think we were a good partnership in politics and a good partnership outside of politics.
Looking at Celia's relationship with Bertie Ahern is almost looking at a most peculiar financial arrangement. Huge amounts of money flowed through accounts opened by Celia Larkin on behalf of Bertie Ahern.
So, on the very day that Ahern's dreams of becoming Taoiseach were vanishing, Celia Larkin paid a visit to the bank carrying a briefcase full of what she says was Micheál Wall's cash.
On the Monday the money was lodged, the evidence from Mr. Wall, Celia Larkin and Bertie Ahern is that none of them counted the money. They can't say precisely how much was in it.
Micheál Wall brings over a briefcase full of money and he didn't count the money, he says. You didn't count the money and Celia didn't count the money when she lodged it. And again, do you accept people find that very hard to believe?
Well, no, Wall didn't say that. I mean, this is the same problem. The facts of it are that Micheál Wall did count the money because he'd used some of the money. He couldn't have it down to the last penny. He said he brought over 30,000, which was put into an account for his use in Celia's name, and that was for the house that he owned.
It was obviously quite a weekend in St. Luke's.
The whole story, you actually couldn't make it up. That he would will the house to Bertie Ahern in the event of his own death. Whoever heard of a landlord doing that?
When you step back from the whole picture, there is a sort of another scenario you can look at. Was it, in fact, Bertie Ahern who was buying the house?
Was Micheál Wall just a front for your purchase?
No, he wasn't. I mean, I think Micheál Wall wanted a house for the reasons that he had in business. We were going to get a house somewhere else. That wasn't our preferred choice. But that's what I did at the time. I rented a house for a few years and then bought it.
The party was in bits. We were all in bits, and it came at a bad time of the year as well. And I remember in January, Bertie said to me, Duffy, he said, opposition is no bleeding cup of joy. He said, let's get the hell out of here quick.
Because we went into opposition, probably in the long term, best thing that happened for Fianna Fáil, the best thing that happened for Bertie Ahern.
I was confident that if we all worked hard, and I kept on saying to colleagues, this is going to be tough work, hard work.
Not only had he to pick himself up, he had to pick up the party, totally reorganise the party.
He had to set up a complete system. So he brought in researchers, advisors. There was a new logo brought in, so a completely new image.
It enabled him to bring young people and new people onto the front bench. It enabled him to do a fundamental policy rethink.
We had 30 papers setting out our vision, our economic vision for the future.
He'd worked very hard to unite the factions in the party during his own time of office as leader.
He barnstormed the country in traditional Fianna Fáil style. Every crossroads was crisscrossed, everybody was met, everybody's hand was pumped.
The research was showing from the very beginning, nobody disliked him.
We worked very closely together in opposition in the Dáil, seeking to put pressure on the government of the day and coordinating our approach to various issues. And there were very good relationships built up over that period.
And in many ways, he built the platform that enabled him subsequently to become Taoiseach for 11 years.
But, you know, it was tough 2 years. I mean, I would have went as many times as I could, quite frankly. Some of my friends would go to every home match.
He'd go over it on regular occasions. Sometimes he'd go on a domestic flight and sometimes he'd go on a private jet.
Opposition was not all work and no play. Bertie Ahern continued his regular trips to Manchester, sometimes at the invitation of local property developer Norman Turner. In the mid-90s, Turner was the driving force behind one of the most ambitious and controversial projects then seen in Ireland.
In the 90s, there was a huge push to rezone the former Phoenix Park racecourse for a major casino gambling operation. It was envisaged, we were told, that perhaps up to nearly 2,000 slot machines would go into the development that was being proposed there.
We want to see a small number of casinos, perhaps licensed by government, supervised, carefully controlled.
I was always against the casino. I wanted to see the hotels and the developments up there. It would have been great. Norman Turner and all the people involved knew that I didn't think the idea of a casino would ever wash.
Say no to sleazy slot machines!
I think that if somebody is flying me to Manchester and taking me into a corporate box to watch United, I'm not sure that they would expect me to be to lead the opposition to their project back home in Ireland.
Norman Turner, though, was providing more than just hospitality at a United game. During this period, he made a large and unusual donation to Fianna Fáil's chief fundraiser, a close ally of Bertie Ahern.
He made a donation to Fianna Fáil. You know, like thousands and thousands of people, they made donations to Fianna Fáil, and that was just another donation.
Des Richardson, at one stage he was given $10,000 in cash by Norman Turner in Manchester, a man he hardly knew, in the course of a liquid lunch, and he brought this money back to Dublin.
Doesn't look good, though, that a man is handing you $10,000 in cash.
Is there something wrong with cash?
Well, there's no traceability, there's no receipts. We don't know who's given it necessarily or what they've given it for if it's in cash.
Well, he gave it in cash, and he gave it to me over a dinner in Manchester.
In dollars?
Yeah.
Why dollars?
Well, he obviously had dollars. I mean, the man worked out of America. I didn't ask him why he had dollars. I didn't ask him why he gave cash. And I made a memo of that, and I handed that memo into Fianna Fáil. So they had a record.
He didn't get a receipt, though.
He didn't want one.
Norman Turner gave money to the party, but denies giving or being asked to give any financial support to Bertie Ahern personally. But the Mahon Tribunal has examined his donation in the light of the lodgement made by Celia Larkin in December 1994, the day that Bertie Ahern was preparing to become Taoiseach.
There is a possibility that payments that were claimed to have been in sterling from Michael Wall may actually have been in dollars from all sorts of sources.
The problem is the bank records. When you look at the bank records, the amount lodged is the exact equivalent of $45,000 using an exchange rate in use on the day and taking into account the commission.
The rate that gives an exact conversion to dollars, however, should not have been used for a sum that size, and Bertie Ahern insists that the lodgement was in sterling with some Irish notes. But the bank records do not show a large sterling lodgement.
On this day, the branch did not buy 27 or 28 or 29,000 pounds worth of sterling. However, exceptionally, it took in enough foreign currency to accommodate $45,000.
What was the currency and where did it come from?
The possibility that a large sum in dollars was lodged that day has in recent years prompted the Mahon Tribunal to investigate a number of potential sources. Norman Turner's development had US backing, but so did another large project being pushed by Cork developer Owen O'Callaghan in 1994.
Well, Owen O'Callaghan effectively had this idea of building a national sports stadium, which at the time a lot of people were demanding, and he got various people involved in the idea.
I got involved because he had a stadium site in Neilstown with planning permission for a stadium. That was huge.
The West Dublin Stadium project was financially backed by an American company called Chilton O'Connor. In March 94, Bertie Ahern had brief discussions on the project during a stopover at Los Angeles Airport. And in November that year, he had another meeting arranged by lobbyist Frank Dunlop.
O'Callaghan, along with Frank Dunlop and Bill O'Connor, who is the senior partner of Chilton O'Connor, meet with Bertie Ahern in the Department of Finance on November the 10th of 94 to discuss the stadium project. Almost 3 weeks later, on the 28th of November, Bill O'Connor writes to Bertie Ahern to congratulate him on his appointment a few days earlier as leader of Fianna Fáil, and said that he hopes they can meet and progress the project further.
The proposed stadium was never built, but the proximity of these contacts to the lodgement on the 5th of December has prompted close examination from the Mahon Tribunal. Both US financier Bill O'Connor and developer Owen O'Callaghan, however, categorically deny giving Bertie Ahern any money for any reason in any currency. Ahern also denies that dollars were lodged to accounts linked to him.
the tribunal are investigating whether the money that Celia lodged to her accounts in December 94 was $45,000.
Yes.
When you first heard that, what did you feel, and is it true?
I thought it was a wind-up, because we never had dollars. And I think the bank evidence of the person who has been to the tribunal many, many times in many days, and the other bank officials, was that they never seen dollars either. But I never did.
By the spring of 1997, Fianna Fáil was preparing for an election. The party faced a tough challenge in unseating the Rainbow government.
We knew we were up against it. The good times were in. Things were up and up for the Rainbow.
Well, I think the key thing about 1997 is that it was not a sure thing. Bertie Ahern was not ordained to become Taoiseach. The Rainbow was not an unpopular government.
It became clear very early on how much was at stake, and Bertie Ahern could be the first Fianna Fáil leader to, you know, not to win a general election and perhaps not to assume power as Taoiseach.
Shortly before the election, Bertie Ahern moved to clear the decks of controversy.
Ben Dunn will name the former Taoiseach Charles Haughey as the recipient of over £1 million from the former supermarket tycoon.
Certainly information was coming out which shocked the ordinary individual in the party.
Fine Gael were running a sort of a rumour mill saying that he was almost umbilically connected to Charles Haughey, and that he was an almost, in a sense, the son of Haughey. And he had to establish that he was a leader of a different stripe.
At the 97 Ardèche, Bertie Ahern moved to distance himself from the man he had once called boss.
I think that was a Friday night, if I recollect. I think he drew a clear line of demarcation and departure. He had to do it.
Well, like all speeches that are important, it's difficult enough to make.
I remember it being very, very fraught. There was a lot of tension around.
We knew that there was a huge vocal element of the party that were still very much pro-Haughey.
I think it did cause some great difficulty to actually deliver that script.
Participation in the democratic life of this country is about public service, not self-service, or the sustaining of a certain lifestyle.
It was basically the erasure of Mr. Haughey from Fianna Fáil's political history.
And even if in the particular instance there were no favours sought or given, we could not condone the practice of senior politicians seeking or receiving from a single donor large sums of money or services in kind.
I know how he operates. All political leaders are a bit, you know, cold-blooded, you know, when it comes to doing their work. He is detached, let me put it that way.
There would be no place in our party today for that kind of past behaviour, no matter how eminent the person involved or the extent of their prior services to the country.
Just business.
It had to be done. It wasn't the easiest of speeches, but it had to be made, and I was glad I made it.
We wanted to make sure that all the facts of the allegations come out into the open about Mr. Dunn, Mr. Lowry, and whoever else is involved. Fianna Fáil are not involved and have nothing to hide. Charlie Haughey has to speak for himself in relation to this. All the facts must come out, whether there's an election called or not.
Dan Corner, I think we should all be very happy today. The sun was out this morning and the rain will be out in a few weeks. And
it was certainly the most successful Fine Gael Labour coalition that has ever been in power in this country.
The rainbow always prevails over the shower.
It was good weather. People were happy to be wooed.
Hi, girls. Hi.
They really were. They were waiting to be wooed, and wooed they were. Bertie was much loved. They loved it when he would be getting or giving a kiss to a lovely young woman. Oh, they were swooning.
You know, new leader, interesting, exciting, different, younger, the kind of campaign theme of a young leader for a young country. Mm-hmm. And I think that he caught, in that year, the public imagination.
They caught this mood. They said they would crack down hard on criminals. They got the support of the Dublin taxi drivers.
I was determined that we got in, and I knew Mary Harney obviously for years. I liked her. I said, listen, you know, we're going to work at this.
The Rainbow push was, you know, we can run a stable coalition.
But what will happen if there's a change of government?
We won't be like Fianna Fáil. You know, Fianna Fáil led coalitions suffer from spontaneous combustion. That won't happen to us.
Fianna Fáil and the Progressive Democrats can work together. Bertie Ahern and I are new young leaders.
The Rainbow never really connected with people. The campaign that they ran was very lackluster. Infamously, there was the famous tour of the three party leaders around an empty Temple Bar. And that kind of summed the whole thing up.
While Bertie Ahern won the PR war, party headquarters decided which candidates would run and where they could canvass for votes.
We had no vote management strategy until 1997. And most Fianna Fáil did this in Montes, and we practiced it nationally, but of course we didn't practice it Bertie's area.
Welcome. Dublin Central exists in a parallel dimension, and woe betide anyone who will get overly involved there.
It's always Bertie, 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 111.
You could take Bertie's car, his house, I'd say you could take the children, the lot. You wouldn't get that upset. As long it doesn't do anything to his constituency.
Bertie Ahern, Fianna Fáil, 12,175.
And there are the figures as you see them. Great cheers for Ahern of Fianna Fáil, a whopping great vote.
Looking good for Fianna Fáil, looking good for Fine Gael, but both DL and the PDs in trouble.
It was a devastating outcome for us, actually. We were very disappointed from, you know, going from 10 down to 4.
It was a disaster from a Rainbow point of view.
Labour Party were absolutely hammered and haven't really seriously recovered from that since.
Do you expect to be Taoiseach?
I hope so, John. Yeah, obviously we'd like to be a few more seats up from what we actually seem to have or may have.
People say that often to me, sure, surely you knew in 97, you know, you knew you were going to win. I didn't make hat, no.
But of course it was a very narrow victory. Fianna Fáil in fact only got over 39% of the vote.
That's all it was, a 0.3% increase, but we got better transfers.
He kept emphasising for the first time that we needed to look at transfers. We needed to be less hostile to other political parties.
Charlie Haughey attracted no transfers. You either were for Haughey or against him.
It was one of his great successes politically that he blurred the lines of Fianna Fáil to the extent of making it acceptable to people who would have been anti-Fianna Fáil all their lives.
And that's been the Bertie trick.
Good evening. Late this afternoon, after 20 years in political life, Bertie Ahern was elected Taoiseach of the 28th Dáil and now presides over a minority coalition government.
Having spent 20 years here, having had an interest in politics from a very young age, it is an honour that is as hard to put into words, Ken Corley, but an honour it really is.
You know, here was our Bertie, having come from nowhere, and managed just through hard work, grit, steely determination to attain this prize.
I had a huge sense of pride that a guy from Drumcondra could make it to the highest office in the land.
Now I don't want to sound big-headed about this, but frankly, that's what we expected. We had moved this thing from victory, 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 and we were now at the top of the pile.
The final race to make Bertie Ahern the youngest ever Taoiseach called on all of his negotiating skills. He struck a deal with the PDs and four supportive independents.
Fianna Fáil are and always will be a party of government. If they have to do deals with other small parties like us or with the Greens, you know, they'll cave in on stuff. And I found that basically whatever we wanted, we got.
The Progressive Democrats and independents were subsequently vital to him becoming Taoiseach. And when he formed that government, many on the other side believed it would not last till Christmas.
One of Bertie Ahern's first decisions as Taoiseach would prove almost fatal for the new government.
Ray was the last one I appointed. I remember being in Dublin Castle in the long room beside St Patrick's Hall, still wondering, and felt it was okay, made a call, and then got into a fair bit of difficulty about it.
A lot of people had heard rumours about Ray Burke right back to the early 70s.
Yes, well, there were rumours around that, unfortunately, Mr. Burke was on the take. It was a very strange start to a government indeed. It's the sort of start you don't want.
So, a big number one for myself and two...
Ray Burke had been a dominant figure in Dublin politics since the 70s and the subject of several inconclusive Garda investigations into planning corruption. Now, before his appointment, rumours were circulating that in 1989, Burke had received £30,000 from a company called Joseph Murphy Structural Engineers.
Yes, the stories were brought to my attention, no doubt about that.
Somebody had come to me, the husband of a member of the Progressive Democrats, who had worked in the Murphy company, had come to me with information between the time of the election and the time that the government was formed. And I put that to Bertie Ahern.
And Mary Horney taught you about it?
I don't know if Mary Horney did, but we certainly had talked about the story being brought to my attention.
Well, I was asked by Bertie Ahern on the Saturday before the formation of that government to go over to London to ask a man called Murphy, had he given money to Ray Burke? I asked him the question, had he given money to Ray Burke? I referred to all the rumours that were going around. He said, no, I can guarantee. He was categoric, so I came home.
Dermot had checked, I had checked. I talked to the Commissioner, the guards, I talked to other people.
You have to remember, this was only literally 48 hours, less than 48 hours before he was formed in the cabinet. Ultimately, it was Bertie Ahern's decision how to react to that. It wasn't my decision.
Well, you're a seasoned veteran of these things.
He assured me that he had it investigated and that there was no truth in it. And once I got the assurances, I wasn't going to be unreasonable. I wasn't going to say somebody isn't acceptable.
Bertie Ahern strongly supported him. It made a lot of people wonder, why was he doing things like this? Maybe these guys, because of the people they were hanging around with, knew what Bertie Ahern had been doing in the early 1990s.
Did he have any information about you and your finances and your funding that would have influenced your judgment?
Nothing. And in fairness to Ray, never would he have a conversation of that. I mean, Ray wanted to get on with the job, wanted to do the job, and I think he thought these things would pass.
Did you appoint him because you were worried if you didn't appoint him, he would make trouble
not
for you?
Not at all.
Well, we were scarcely back in the Dáil when the Ray Burke affair erupted.
I've come here today to defend my personal integrity, the integrity of my party, of this government, and the honour of this house.
Over the summer, the public finally got to hear the stories about Ray Burke.
Regarding Ray Burke, I received endless numbers of anonymous letters, and I've been just about up every tree in North County Dublin, chasing all kinds of things.
Did the minister not have any sense, two gentlemen arriving with £30,000 in cash, did you not for one moment think of the implications?
I'm being judged on 1997 rules for a contribution that was received in 1989.
I made myself available for questions from members for an hour on any issue they wanted to ask. As far as I'm concerned, that's a line in the sand.
At the end of the day, he wasn't called Rambo for no reason.
Whatever allegations, whatever pranks, whoever comes out of the woodwork...
Will this government survive? Can it survive? It won't survive.
From now on, the line is in the sand.
I started saying to myself, this is not going to last long.
No more scapegoats.
That government was formed in June, and by September we were into an unsustainable situation as far as Ray Burke was concerned, and the issue just wasn't going away. We can't go on this issue dominating the news week in, week out.
It was as though the state of the government was basically hanging on to Mary Harney's trembling bottom lip.
But I didn't put any demands on him. I think he knew what needed to be done, and he did it.
what I'm going to do is to set up a separate inquiry, hopefully it would not be a very lengthy inquiry, that can examine all the matters to do with this particular site.
I think that Mr. Burke had been given an assurance by Mr. Ahern that under no circumstances will there be a tribunal into Mr. Burke's affairs.
Bertie Ahern maintained there had to be an inquiry, and the position of Ray Burke became untenable.
Ray Burke finally bowed to the intense pressure surrounding him and resigned as a member of the government.
He obviously felt that Bertie should have done more to support him. He blamed Bertie for it.
As long as ministers who were involved in sustaining and defending repeatedly the haughty system of government remain as ministers in cabinet, will the country not continue to sit on the edge of its seat waiting for the next revelation?
I'd just like to assure people outside, you know, all this we're trying to do is to clean up the past.
The public representatives must not be under a personal financial obligation to anyone.
And where there is wrongdoing, people are found guilty, and they take the same penalties as others do.
The planning tribunal provided a safety valve for a shaken coalition, a place to park allegations of corruption while the government bedded down. Over the years, however, the tribunal would move ever closer to the man who established it.
You know, when you look back, life is strange. It was Bertie Ahern and the Taoiseach who set up those tribunals. And I think the last person anyone would have thought would have ended up being caught up in them was Bertie Ahern.
And I know people want to say that I don't want to move forward, that I'm really part of the people who I was here with 20 years ago. I'm not.
I think it was to be for a few years. I thought it could have been as long as the end of the century, the last one.
Well, the Secretary General of my new department, when I went in the first day in social welfare, he said to me, "Minister, you're coming into this department at the best time in the history of the state." He said, "Unemployment figures are dropping, you know, the money is there."
There's a fair bit of luck in that, because, I mean, it's not the first time that people say generals, as well as being good, have to be lucky. Bertie was lucky, so we got the breaks.
You couldn't have had a Taoiseach who was more suited to operating a coalition, to smoothing over differences.
You know, he convened meetings, he didn't ram it through, would never allow anything to be rammed through the cabinet. Probably the experience in 94 taught him that.
We've never had a vote during my time at cabinet because it's always done on consensus.
Sometimes you could get very frustrated about this consensus building. I'd be much more impatient and want to cut to the chase.
In the early days, you used to get frustrated by it. Like, Bertie would let things drift and want about making a decision, and then he'd be worried, then someone would have to make a decision. Oh, God, that's it. But you say at the end, you know, you'd say, I used to say, Jesus, sure, look, lad, sure, it works.
Well, his style was leaving a certain amount to ourselves and guessing what way he wanted us to do it. I mean, we'd only found out if we did it wrong or if we did it correctly afterwards.
I have to say, it's a bit of a trick, but it's fun. What I would do is I'd go in and I'd say, Joe Bloggs said this, and I think this is a good idea, but I think it was off the wall. And then you'd say to somebody, what do you think?
You've got to decode Bertie. We had some humorous moments when he would say things to us, and we'd leave, and we'd, myself, John Walsh and John Donnelly would try and work out what Bertie was really at, in terms of what he just said at the front bench meeting.
Yes, it was an interesting management style, but it seemed to get the job done.
It's in politics you have to draw people out. If you go in as leader, and I watched the styles of others before me, if you go in as leader and say, this is my view, and I want to do this, then all your colleagues will agree. When you go in and say something in the middle or something against what you will, and then ask your colleagues, then you get the truth.
You know, he didn't necessarily go at things straight up, but he knew what he wanted to achieve.
This strategy of confuse and rule was perhaps apparent in the first electoral test Bertie Ahern faced as Taoiseach.
Bertie and presidential elections have a bit of a history.
It was obvious in the summer of 1997 that Fianna Fáil would have to pick a person to contest the presidency. And Albert Reynolds was clearly very, very interested in that position.
Did you shaft Albert for the presidential nomination?
No, I did not. I spoke to Albert, thought he would be a good candidate, considered him a good candidate, considered him the right age for a candidate, if you know what I mean.
At the same time, you had senior ministers going around, scouting around, looking for candidates, so that they would have somebody other than Albert Ramos. I've changed my
mind. But what happened was circumstances changed. Other Fianna Fáil candidates came into the ring. And then our guys got worried. They said, listen, we're only a few months in government. We're going to have all these tribunals and all of the rest. You know, is there other options?
Bertie Ahern didn't make all the moves there. There were a number of ministers who had been dismissed by Albert Reynolds who had no reasons to love him.
And then a number of guys started saying, well, there is another option.
I think it is important to have a range of options to go before the people so the people can express their view.
Mary McAleese was the chosen person. A small group of people knew that from early on. Like all good things in politics, there was nothing personal about it.
Bertie had let us know the day before at a cabinet meeting that, now he never said her by name and he never said Albert by name, but each one of us left that cabinet table knowing that Mary McAleese was the one he favoured.
The Fianna Fáil party meets tomorrow to select their candidate, with the Michael O'Kennedy and Albert Reynolds campaigns in full swing.
I said, but Albert, is the Taoiseach supporting you in this? And he assured me that he was.
Albert was quite sure he was going to get it. I don't know what Michael O'Kennedy was sure of.
Some people did say, you know, tell Albert get out of this. But I mean, I didn't know what the vote was.
I think we all knew going into the parliamentary meeting what the result was going to be.
When the voting took place in the meeting, I recall seeing one Minister of State saying, how do you spell McAleese?
Bertie showed Albert his slip, and written on it was Albert Reynolds.
And learning this, the MEP for Munster, Brian Crowley, said to Albert Reynolds, well, you're f***ed now, Albert.
Thank you very much indeed, Taoiseach. Can I tell you how deeply grateful I am, first of all, to the Fianna Fáil parliamentary party.
I saw Albert after that vote, and it was as close as I've ever seen to a man alive who was actually dead, if I can put it that way.
Look, it's her day, it's not mine, so...
He was pallid, he was shook.
Well, I mean, how do you feel?
Very disappointed.
More people swung with what they seen as a new, fresh candidate, and that was how things worked out.
I didn't think that Mr. Reynolds was properly treated, no. By a small group of people, it's a powerful group of people.
Keen to distance themselves from their past, Fianna Fáil's selection of a fresh face in Mary McAleese proved an astute move.
I hereby declare Mary McAleese elected to the office of President of Ireland.
I think up to that, you know, there would have been one or two who would have said, you know, he's not as good as what has come before. I think after her election, I think people then regarded Bertie as a huge, you know, plus for the party and a very strong character.
It was a Friday evening, and we were just around the corner when the Talbot Street bomb went on. You know, before the cordons and the blocks went up, we saw the mayhem, saw the carnage. I think all our lives, I mean, we were being brought up, and the first item was the funeral. Another effort at trying to find a solution, collapses, more people suffering, more children crying. You know, it was our whole life. I mean, it never changed from 68 to 98. I met Tony Blair in opposition in the Gresham Hotel, and we decided that if both of us got to the other side of the line, and that if he was Prime Minister and I was Taoiseach, that we would give this a real go.
Both Bertie and I think came to the relationship between our two countries
you know, shorn of a lot of the baggage. I hadn't quite realised, I mean, it's my kind of ignorance, I just hadn't quite realised that the relationship was supposed to be a very difficult one.
When I came to the Taoiseach's department first in the late 70s, a phone call between the British Prime Minister and the Irish Prime Minister took a week to organise.
The British tape everything, which wasn't our culture. I mean, you can be sure that when you're talking to the British Prime Minister, if it's not been taped by his office, MI5. So Tony and I worked out a system where we used to talk to each other, where at least we reckoned the system wasn't taping us, maybe the others were.
The Docklands area of London has been bombed by the IRA.
I mean, the Canary Wharf bomb had blown the peace process out of the water. When we came into power, there were no discussions, no negotiations, there was no ceasefire.
I think that's what it's about. And the fact that there's another chance.
And very soon after we came into office, I think it was around the 20th of July, the IRA reinstated ceasefire. So we were technically back in business.
Today is the start of a new stage of the peace process where we'll have many practical difficulties, we'll have many problems to deal with.
Negotiations chaired by the former US Senator George Mitchell had been dragging on and off for years. In April 98, Mitchell finally called time on the talks.
When he set down a time limit to end the negotiations, that really crystallised people's minds.
David Trimble would need to understand that my compromises have completed.
And without him compromising, there'll be no deal.
Precisely.
It was always going to be a big week.
Bertie Ahern, though, was soon caught up in a personal tragedy at home.
I mean, it was constantly up and down to, you know, Stormont. And particularly then, when the mother was ill at the time, he was constantly worried about her.
On that Sunday morning, my mother got a heart attack. I was in the matter. Bertie was in the middle of negotiations with Gerry Adams. Now, I can remember the doctor at the time saying, you must tell him, you must tell him now.
I went into all of the other meetings, finished the meetings, and then went back to the matter and, you know, stayed all night on the Sunday night with my mother till she died on Monday morning.
Then Bertie left us and went back up to Belfast. Now, again, I know that was, I'm sure, wonderful and was very important for the negotiations, but we would have liked to have him there.
It was a deadline. Nobody could say, you know, we can cancel this for another week, and I knew that too, and my mother would have understood that. We had to keep going.
The general expectation in Northern Ireland was that, like everything else, this wouldn't work.
Is this document a dead letter, as far as you're concerned?
I wouldn't touch it on a 40-foot pole.
When I flew over for the negotiation, I remember having a conversation with Senator George Mitchell. He was basically said, I don't think this is going to happen.
On Wednesday, Bertie Ahern was back in Dublin to attend his mother's funeral. But in the north, the talks had reached crisis point.
There are issues here, particularly on constitutional matters, which I think do have to, at the end of the day, be settled by the man at the top.
I said, what we need to do is get him and Prime Minister Blair together such that they can decide on this issue.
I always remember when the funeral ended on the Wednesday and a poor civil servant from Foreign Affairs was sent over to me, tapped me on the shoulder. The civil servant said, listen, you have to get back to the north. I'm sorry, Taoiseach.
He was coming back to a deal that the British felt was falling through.
I fully expected him to come back because he was central to the negotiations.
I remember him coming into the room. His mother had just died and he was obviously actually very close to her and very upset. And actually was, in a way, I think quite determined to get it done.
I feel the hand of history upon our shoulder in respect of this. I really do.
I remember walking up from Stormont House with David Andrews, and we had heard Tony Blair on the radio that morning, and I joked to David, I said it could be, you know, the boot of history up the you-know-what just as easily.
We were into a very difficult period.
Well, first of all,
you know, factor in that everybody's tired.
We've been locked up in castle buildings, which is not a place to be locked up in, incidentally.
It's a very sick building. It's a building which is seriously unwell.
The talks went almost non-stop for the 48 hours.
It's all low-ceilinged. It's like Castlereagh Interrogation Centre with coffee.
So we asked Sinn Féin for what their issues were, and they produced a list of 76 different items.
They were serious observations that we wanted to see addressed.
Mo freaked and took off, minus the shoes and the hair, and she was really mad.
Mo Mullen was saying, there is no that way this deal will be done.
It looked as if it was over then, and Tony said, what are we going to do? And I said I was going to go in and start going through these items.
I mean, Bertie had a tremendous capacity just to keep going in these situations, which was really important.
One thing you learn about negotiations, it's not over until it's over. And you can't at any time drop your guard.
He basically kept them there through the night.
So back we went, and one by one. And I went through and gave our position on every one of those issues.
It's actually just when you think it's going to end badly that it moves forward again.
Many of the checks, balances and safeguards which we argued for during the negotiations have now been secured.
And it wasn't really until we looked at the television and there was Mitchell McLachlan on the television turning the combined media, yes, we now believe that this deal can be done.
As they say, I mean, we give this commitment, we'll work right up until the very last second.
Pressure now switched to the unionists, who had not expected Sinn Féin to sign up.
It was a long, hard fight.
David Trimble was under huge pressure. There were rumours of walkouts. At one point, nobody had seen unionist delegates from the unionist party for, you know, an hour or two. There was a fear that David Trimble was going to lose it.
We had a row. It was on the implementation bodies, and he didn't want to have many of these things, really. And I had to have a north-south dimension. That was the issue.
When I came to the meeting with the Irish delegation to sort it out, I just was going to get it sorted out, and I was not going to get involved in any discussion on the matter.
A lot of criticism, a lot of history. You just took it on the chin and kept going.
But I can remember him at various moments saying, Paddy, take it easy, take it easy.
He knew in the end that whether there was peace didn't really depend on the intricacies of each line of the agreement, but whether people could establish the right trust and confidence together.
And then George Mitchell just called it. He just decided, you know, we've gone on long enough. There's no more to talk about.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, you will have heard that Senator Mitchell's announcement has been made that an agreement has been reached.
And then I remember the speed with which we got into the room, got the thing agreed. You know, we had to do it really quickly, the two of us, because we knew if we allowed any further deliberation, it would disintegrate again.
People were too fatigued, really, to be euphoric. We were just all wasted.
The Good Friday Agreement stands out as a moment that very few moments will match again.
To the Taoiseach, the Irish Prime Minister, whom I have found to be a man of courage and tenacity and integrity.
You saw a person displaying a colossal degree of skill, not just in one aspect, but in several aspects.
Bertie, thank you for all you did. It's a very difficult week, very difficult week.
Yes, 71.12%.
Majority of votes in favour of the proposal, 1,356,835.
Nobody thought that this would be the man who actually brought the Irish people to abandon Articles 2 and 3 of the Constitution. When you look back on it now, and when I, in my lifetime, look back on that, I wasn't sure that that could have been done.
I would really have liked if it had been the case that Bertie Ahern showed that determination that he showed in the Northern peace process more often. It would have been great if he had displayed that on other occasions as well.
But the big issues had to be parked. Policing had to be parked. You know, the issue of decommissioning was vague. There was a sense of foreboding that when people realised the scale of what we had agreed, I just wondered whether we could pull it off, no matter how long it took, whether it would stick.
I did not ever dream that the worst atrocity of the entire Troubles would happen as it did on the 15th of August at 3:10. But for me, it just toughened my mettle. And, you know, Olmuth said to me is, I'm going to stick with this matter what.
The government was run by three people. One of those three people had to be changed.
Celia devoted the best years of her life to Bertie Ahern. She just had about enough.
The way that he was seen, yeah, that was bad.
It's cost me a fortune, it's cost me everything I had.
I think the initial reaction was one of shock.
And you can catch that final part of Bertie next Monday night at 9:35 here on RTÉ One.
We face into an Ireland of great promise. An Ireland at peace with itself for the first time in more than 1,000 years.
Well, I think it was tremendously exciting. We were a lucky generation in some respects.
And I was prepared and did to dedicate every hour of the God-given day to make it work.
Fianna Fáil will bridge the dream of centuries and create an Ireland of peaceful prosperity.
After a turbulent first year as Taoiseach, Bertie Ahern was about to embark on a decade in power that would see Ireland transformed.
And you will be there to see it, forever meal among it.
These would be the Bertie years, where the man at the top would reach new highs and new lows.
Where you going? You're not coming back.
He is associated with the boom times. The end of his tenure was the bust time.
Bertie Ahern helped to make the future.
Are you nervous?
Why did you do it like this?
I never detected the big groundswell against Bertie or for Bertie. His strength is with the Irish people.
But in the end, he couldn't escape the past.
Well, it's stupid.
Warm welcome to the EU Commissioner for Employment and Social Affairs, Padraig Flynn. Here he is, big fella.
My memories are of sitting down to watch The Late Late that night and then of just seeing a series of horrific implosions.
I get, give or take, about a net 100,000. And out of that 100,000, I run a home in Dublin, Castlebar, and Brussels. I want to tell you something. Try it sometime.
Horrick Flynn's appearance on The Late Late at the start of 1999 was a personal disaster.
What are you going to do about the Flood Tribunal and the 50 grand, Gilmore?
Well, I want to tell you about that. I've said my piece about that.
It would also, in time, prove catastrophic for Bertie Ahern.
But you know Gilmart.
Oh, yeah.
You know Tom Gilmart.
Yeah. I haven't seen him now for some years.
Tom Gilmartin was an English-based developer who had blazed into Dublin in the late 1980s with ambitious plans to develop shopping centres.
All as I knew about him at the time, that he was a big developer from England. I mean, to be honest, from my position, I'm sorry I heard about him then or since, but that's my position.
He was looking at developing a large shopping centre out where Quarryvale now is, Liffey Valley.
And indeed had assembled a very important strategically located site before the big players in Dublin business realised. And that's where his problems in a way began.
Gilmartin spent millions developing a site at Quarryvale, which opened as the Liffey Valley Centre in late 98. By then, he had lost control of the project to his business partner, Owen O'Callaghan. Now, stories began to appear about Tom Gilmartin's time in Ireland.
But Tom Kilmartin's allegation is that when he was trying to develop his Quarry Vale project, he discovered people wanted money.
The details were sparse.
There was the allegation that he'd given £50,000 to Porrig Flynn.
He's not well.
That really provoked and annoyed Tom Kilmartin.
His wife isn't well.
Yeah, that really got him fired up.
He's out of sorts.
They responded to what Mr. Flynn had to say on television.
Tom Kilmartin then decided he would come to Dublin and he would give evidence.
Now, another major key witness had come forward to the tribunal with quite startling allegations in relation to political corruption.
You're not actually saying that you didn't get this money?
I think if people take contributions of 30, 40, 50,000, it's very hard to explain. And for that reason, I do not think people should do that.
For now, Tom Gilmartin's allegations were focused on Porrig Flynn, but he had already been in contact with the tribunal about the Taoiseach.
Mr. Gilmartin is quoted as saying that even if Bertie Ahern survives this week, he won't survive what I have coming down the line for him.
There were lots and lots of difficulties with that government, that a lot of them got sorted out because of the relationship between himself and Mary Harney.
What was Sheedy about?
Yeah, Sheedy was a very difficult issue and caused a lot of problems.
Philip Sheedy was a young architect who had been convicted of killing a mother of two while driving drunk. He had also worked with a close associate of Bertie Ahern, Joe Burke. In April 1999, it emerged that Philip Sheedy had been released from prison early in unusual circumstances. Two judges and a court official resigned in the aftermath, and then Bertie Ahern broke some news to his Taoiseach.
Bertie Ahern came to me and told me that he had made representations to the Department of Justice for the early release of Philip Sheedy. I asked him to put it on the record of the Dáil. It was important that he should choose to do that, and he agreed to do that.
But before facing the Dáil, the Taoiseach spoke to the newspapers.
And I was absolutely furious about that.
But given that Mary Harney asked you on two occasions to speak to the Dáil...
I don't think Mary Harney did that, you see, and I'm not going to get into that.
And furthermore, he said that he didn't agree to do that.
Eileen, as I was certain that Taoiseach was going to put on the Dáil record, there was no doubt about it.
I did really think that day that the government was about to come to an end.
The Taoiseach says that the government are going to run for another 3 years. Do you see it like that at this stage?
I don't know about that.
These kind of issues that blow up, that attract big media attention, where people can see an injustice. And you can understand that.
The cabinet meeting was being held the next day. I didn't go to the meeting at the start. And Charlie McGreevy ended up as the mediator between both of us.
I did not get a good opening to mention the matter in the Dáil, as I had hoped at question time last week. But equally, I accept that I was remiss in not finding some way of doing so.
It took Mary a little while to get used to the Bertie style, which I can readily understand. Let's put it like that.
There was an element of a triumvirate in it. There were three consuls, and clearly Bertie was the first consul. But Charlie McCreevy was a man with a very strong mind of his own.
How much freedom did you give Charlie McCreevy?
A lot.
Well, Bertie knew what he was getting when he made him Minister of Finance. I am heavily influenced by, say, having competition, free markets. I was lucky enough we were in government with the Progressive Democrats, and I knew the Progressive Democrats were there to back me up.
He once said to me, if I was in a government, a majority Fianna Fáil government, I couldn't have slashed the taxes as quickly as I did.
Charlie was in at 7 in the morning. Charlie was there late. I trusted that he would get on and make decisions. I would argue with him on some things. He wouldn't be the missing socialist we've been looking for years, but he had a good social conscience. And remember all the huge increases for social welfare were given by Charlie.
Straight out of the traps in 1997, they started reforming the tax system, they started lowering tax. And it was a government that, you know, you had a sense, had a set of targets that it wanted to achieve.
You take, for example, the Asia strategy, very far-seeing. Now we're all talking about China and India. 10 years ago, in 1999, he set up the idea of an Asia strategy. And we had our trade missions to India and China.
I think addressing the issues of poverty, huge strides were made. I think addressing the issues of the elderly, massive strides were made.
He became Taoiseach in 1997. Within 3 years, the Irish economy had grown by a third in the space of 3 years. And it was a phenomenal performance.
While Ireland boomed, the Planning Tribunal was excavating the recent past. In April 2000, it appeared to make a breakthrough. Frank Dunlop, a prominent lobbyist, revealed details of his activities in the early 90s.
Frank Dunlop was the front man for Mr. O'Callaghan in the rezoning of Quarry Vale for what is now the Liffey Valley Shopping Centre.
Dunlop says he set up a war chest which he used to pay bribes in cash to a whole range of politicians.
A spider web is tangled up with me.
But he says he never told Owen O'Callaghan what he was up to.
It was Spy Wednesday, appropriately named, when Frank Dunlop came into the tribunal. He agreed to write names on a piece of paper, the names of politicians to whom he had made payments.
Bertie Ahern was not one of those identified by Frank Dunlop, but that same week his name did surface in a separate allegation which would prove to be false.
In Easter Sunday, I think it was, 2000, Frank Connolly wrote a huge article of several pages that I had taken 50,000 bribe at the All-Ireland Final of 1989.
This was from Starry O'Brien.
This is from Starry O'Brien.
Starry O'Brien, as he was known, he said that he paid Bertie Ahern a cheque for £50,000 in the car park of the Burlington Hotel on behalf of the Cork developer Owen O'Callaghan.
So, I mean, I went out the following day, I was in Arbor Hill, and I rejected it.
I never received one penny from Owen O'Callaghan, for myself, for the party, or for anyone else.
It very quickly became clear to everybody that this guy was not a credible person to be making an allegation like this.
I'm standing in all the rain, that's what I'm doing now.
My legal people told me that wasn't good enough, I'd have to go to the courts and fight it.
We apologised to Mr. O'Callaghan and to Bertie Ahern and retracted the story. The judge said that Mr. Ahern was absolutely cleared and awarded the maximum damages.
Bertie Ahern had faced down the allegation and proven his innocence in this case.
I choose to sue so that the Irish public could see that this allegation was false and malicious.
But in the years to come, a similar allegation would surface at the tribunal.
Were you worried on taking office that people might not accept Celia's role?
No, I wasn't. I mean, Celia was my partner. She worked very hard. And when we were abroad, she worked very hard. She took her role seriously and worked very hard at it. And I was appreciative of, obviously, when you're travelling the world and somebody is with you. And that was a big help to me, and I appreciated it.
They seemed very close and very much a team in terms of his political life. And she herself is a very competent political operator.
Ms. Larkin, who left the Taoiseach's side immediately after arriving, entered the reception without the Taoiseach.
We did get into a few tiffles and a few functions.
In May 2001, the Taoiseach hosted a reception for Cardinal Connell. Celia Larkin's role as official partner was called into question.
In fairness, it was not of his making. Other people did send me some tough letters, but I definitely got a prize collection of letters from other senior people.
What do you mean?
Senior church people.
I think the key thing about Bertie, for the good things and the bad things about him, or the perception of him, people see a lot of themselves or their own family. I mean, no other leading Irish politician had been there, and that's an experience common to a lot of Irish families.
Through the Bertie years, traditional deference to authority was on the wane, for the church and also for Ireland's political masters.
We've done well. We've done very well. We've done extraordinarily well. Now time to stand up and pay a bit back.
I can remember the Nice Treaty, the first Nice Treaty, very well. I wasn't very long working in government buildings at the time. It was taken for granted that there would be a yes vote.
There are consequences, very serious economic and political consequences, in my view, by a vote which would be inimical to our national interest.
I mean, I think people were, to some extent, sleepwalking.
Within 1 hour of the ballot boxes being opened here at the RDS this morning, it was clear from the tallies that Dublin was saying no to Nice.
All the media, without exception, all the political parties, with the exception of the Greens, all of the trade unions,
All the employers' organisations, the farmers' organisations, all said, we have to vote yes. Very good. And the Irish people said, yeah, that's very good advice, and said no.
I think it's remarkably healthy development.
But as I've said, there is no obvious or simple solution at this time.
The most glaring failure was his personal failure to sell the Nice Treaty to the electorate. Popularity is not much good, Taoiseach, unless you do something constructive with it.
Minutes into my warning, and all I have got so far is just saying, shelter, get off the bike, get into shelter. Don't drink the water.
Yes, yes. Take your iodine tablet.
Yeah, how did I get my iodine tablet?
That will be in the fact sheet when it gets to your home, okay?
Oh, poor Joe. I did actually hear that interview. And I think every politician in the Dáil had great sympathy for him.
No, but you Marianne, tell me, no, you have no, the fact sheet Marianne, in front of you. How do I get my iodine tablet?
We mustn't be alarmistic.
Because at the end of the interview, the whole country felt unsafe.
The government is on full alert. We have the finest public administration in Europe.
In late 2001, the government rehearsed plans to cope with a theoretical meltdown at Sellafield. But across the Atlantic, a real threat had emerged.
9/11 was a huge rebuff, and it sent shockwaves, particularly through all the foreign direct investment companies.
I think we went from an annualised growth rate about 8.8% to 0.1% in the last quarter of 2001.
Though the economy stalled, the government kept public spending flowing ahead of the election due by mid-2002.
Finance Minister Charlie McCreevy stunned the European Commission with a spending spree of unprecedented proportions and the biggest tax cuts in the history of the state.
In a way, it fed an awful lot of expectation.
Take your marks.
Fantastic. Fantastic, yeah. I mean, we could do nothing wrong in that election, really. Started off with Showtime with the Shelburne, and it went up from there.
There's an awful lot of work put in by a lot of people. Maybe that's the reason why I'm born again. And he had himself, I recall, quite a superstition about the need to have elections when the weather was good.
Kiss.
How are you doing, girls? Hardly great to see you.
A lot done, more to do. It's one of the great election slogans ever, and it worked.
I can confirm that there are no significant overruns projected, and no cutbacks whatsoever are being planned, secretly or otherwise.
He had prodigious physical energy in terms of the amount of territory he would cover against a flatness and emptiness on the Fine Gael side.
Competition wasn't, you know, it was like winning a soccer match 5-0.
The notion of an overall majority started to emerge in our heads. It was like the goal that dare not speak its name.
You don't want something achieved by stealth. You don't want Fianna Fáil coming in under the public's radar screen and achieving an overall majority.
The kind of hoodoo about the notion that Fianna Fáil gets an overall majority, they'll, you know, it'll rampage around the country like King Kong or something. The last 72 hours of the campaign, I very vividly remember one headline, I think it was, "It's all over, bar the voting."
Bertie Ahern is certain to be Taoiseach, certain to have 80. It's a stunning result for Fianna Fáil.
We should have comfortably got an overall majority and just a little bit of vote management. The people gave us the overall majority. We, as a political party, gave it back.
Election 2002 was still a stunning victory for Bertie Ahern.
We won it.
Great!
He had come within a few seats of winning an overall majority, a feat that was last achieved in the 70s. But to stay in power, Ahern needed to strike a new deal with the PDs, and their price was the Bertie Bowl.
There was an awful tension around the stadium. Clearly, it was something Bertie Ahern really wanted. He's hugely interested in sport. I mean, the costings were, oh, skyrocket. They were at one point $1 billion. I think he himself realised that trying to sell the concept of a stadium was a step too far at that juncture. He's the consummate pragmatist. He knew that if that was, you know, the price of doing a deal with the Progressive Democrats in government, he would walk away from it.
That's probably one of the hardest things I did. I've made mistakes in my life. It was a mistake not to have a national stadium.
And it's the historic challenge of the government that takes office today to ensure that the Good Friday Agreement is not a false dawn and that our economic development does not prove to be fool's gold.
After the victory came the hangover. The post 9/11 slump had blown a hole in the public finances. Charlie McCreevy now moved to plug it.
Charlie McCreevy said, "We're going the wrong road, boys and girls, and we've got to get on the right road again."
I cut back expenditure pretty dramatically. Why did I do that? Well, the situation had changed.
We cannot keep going on increasing willy-nilly the vote going to health at the expense of all other departments.
My political view is you get one chance to go in with the knife.
Thanks, lads. Lads, is there any way I can cut your salaries a bit? No cutbacks whatsoever are being planned.
The perception took hold that we'd actually fooled the people and conned our way into power. And there was a huge backlash against that.
But that was all out in the public domain at the time, and that's what the people voted on.
McCreevy and myself in particular had to take the brunt of making the correct decisions, decisive decisions, that would ultimately pull the country around quickly.
Community employment schemes throughout the country, they began to be cut back.
In my own constituency, 3 to 4 schools which we had promised in the election would be built were actually cancelled. There was a very large backlash.
Our own party were aggravated at us, the electorate was aggravated at us.
The budgets were being pared back fairly dramatically. We did the right thing for the economy.
There was some good news for the government. The Nice Treaty passed second time round. But still, the problems kept piling up.
There's an old adage in politics that if one thing goes wrong, well then 5, 6, 7, 8 things go wrong.
We are being ejected from office because the government has failed to honour its obligation.
This agreement is over.
It is difficult. There are problems. There's no good anyone denying that. There are a lot of tensions.
Our poll rating again was going through the floor, and there seemed to be an unending series of scandals of one kind and the other and accidents.
Deputy G.V. Wright was found to have an alcohol level above the legal limit.
We're experiencing extreme turbulence, and there was a sense that the government was out of touch.
January 2003, the last section of the Millennium Spire is finally put in place. Years late and way over budget.
It doesn't serve any purpose, does it? Except maybe Bertie would like to sit on the top of it.
The spire was loose change amongst the billions spent every year by the government. Yet well into Bertie Ahern's second term, Ireland's infrastructure strained to keep up with the boom.
People were beginning to ask questions and say, sometimes it feels as if we're living in an economy rather than in a society. If we have all of this money, why do we still have all of these prefabs in schools and we don't have a school building project that should be where it is?
There were various examples of where there seems to be an extreme laziness in the spending of public money. That's how we ended up with things like the PPAR system being an absolute disaster and the health service costing hundreds of millions. Things like the electronic voting machines also being a waste of money. But in particular in relation to things like roads, we had overspends.
We had to develop the mechanisms of being able to spend on big capital programmes. Up until that, it was always piecemeal, a bit this year, a bit next year. It was a bad year, nothing the year after. So we hadn't got the system.
It took us a while to learn from our mistakes, but I think we have.
There appeared to be so much money swashing around in the system that they took the brakes off in controlling public expenditure. Current day-to-day public expenditure was going through the roof. House prices were going through the roof.
It was becoming evident that the guard, the nurse, the civil servant were finding that buying a house was a goal that was getting outside of their grasp.
We had the benchmarking report, which granted average 9% pay increases across the board in the public sector. And it was a case of saying, well, look, rather than deal with the house price spiral, let's ensure that the average guard married to the nurse gets paid more money in order to do it. It was an expensive solution which sidestepped a problem.
We had the crazy decentralization system, which seemed to be designed to keep people around the country happy. The imperative always seemed to be get the deal on the day and the future can look after itself.
I wanted to decrease the national debt dramatically. I wanted to write down the national debt. So that was my first priority. My second one was, and we share this with Charlie, that wealth creators was a good thing in the country. What we wanted to do then is share the wealth.
By the second period in government, the focus was on driving economic growth.
It's estimated every time a house changes hands, €87,000 goes to the taxman.
The property boom fueled growth and provided the government with huge resources. But soaring prices could not be sustained forever.
The higher house prices went, that was a symbol of economic achievement rather than something that was storing up a potential future storm.
I think it was an error to relax policy when they did, and a consequence of that is the pain that we're suffering now.
I mean, in the presidency in 2004, I travelled the world in 6 months. My job was to get 27 governments on side.
For 6 months in 2004, Bertie Ahern was effectively President of Europe. It was Ireland's turn to take the chair at EU meetings, and the Taoiseach set himself the ambitious task of securing a deal on a new constitution for Europe.
He knew the stakes were very high. He knew that for a small country like ours, if we could pull it off, there would be great kudos.
There was no expectation across Europe that Ireland could bring it together. But it was an all-consuming mission for those 6 months.
During the presidency, in all the hours we spent on the government jet crisscrossing the capitals of Europe, he never once took his head out of the brief. He is one of the most focused and disciplined people I have ever come across.
Another day, and it seems another late night at the European office for Bertie Ahern.
Yeah, well, for the 2 days, we spent 2 days tied down, and there were about half a dozen issues, as there always is. So what I did was I tried to, you know, click off one by one. I called in all of the main players, Gerhard Schroeder, Jacques Chirac, and we trashed it out. And as it went into the night, it was coming clear we could actually crack it. Now, they were watching my style. They knew me fairly well, but watching my style, they believed that we could do it.
Piece by piece, it's slowly getting there.
He's a very, very sharp, very intelligent guy. And when he was negotiating, getting the countries to sign up to the constitutional treaty for Europe, which he really did, that could not have been done without a lot of really skilled negotiation.
And, you know, when it was finally agreed, obviously it was a great moment.
We reached the end of an Irish presidency that will live in our memories as a great presidency.
His standing was huge. They wanted him to be president of the Commission. I mean, that job was on the table for him at the end of that negotiation. He didn't want to take it.
During the EU presidency, Ireland's Taoiseach showed he could hold his own with world leaders. The constitution would, however, be rejected in a French referendum. And even as Bertie Ahern was striking the deal, the news at home was bleak.
Taoiseach, you look a bit upset this morning, clearly. No. You look as if you're a bit shocked.
Well, I've lost over 20% of the council seats. Listen, we got hammered in the local elections in 2004, and the people spoke, and they didn't like some of the policies that we get.
It was the worst performance at local level since the 1920s.
Right, I just said, Charlie, we lost the election.
Policies that are being implemented by the government are too much in line with right-wing policies, with the Progressive Democrats, and I think that has to be changed.
Oh, to be whinging and giving up. But your backbencher's life is to whinge.
Well, I think it was very clear that there were three people in the government, him, Mary Harney and Charlie McCreevy, and that in some sense, one of those three people had to be changed.
How serious was it for Bertie's leadership?
I think it was serious enough.
Now, Mary Harney wasn't going to change because she led a separate party in government.
I think Bertie Ahern made sure it wasn't him that was changing.
And in the end, the decision was made. Charlie McCreevy moved to Brussels.
I think Charlie McCreevy was being blamed.
Charlie McCreevy, like myself, is a pragmatic person. He knew we had to make some change.
In July, most other countries had nominated their commissioners, and he said, do you want this job or not? And I said, let me think about it.
Now, he did kind of half change his mind once or twice.
I thought about it for a week, and I said yes.
The Taoiseach and I have developed a close personal relationship over a long period of time. I'd say I know 25% of Bertie Ahern, but that's about 24% that anybody else knows, I'd say.
Bertie Ahern moved quickly to quell unrest following the stunning local election defeat. TDs were summoned to an away day in Cork to hear the new message of social concern.
Bertie learned the lesson. That was the message he got from the TDs. We had a think-in in Inchy Donny. He announced that he was of the left-wing persuasion within Fianna Fáil.
The people in society that need help, the old, the disabled, people who are marginalised, we like to target those resources in a meaningful way, an efficient way to help those people.
I mean, I think you could overstate all of that, an Inch of Donny and change of direction. I don't think it was a change of direction, to be honest. I think our party had a very strong social conscience.
I like to see a country of equality. I am a true Republican. I'm a true socialist. I believe in sharing. I believe in caring.
Well, you see, only Bertie Ahern could get away with, on the one hand, saying that he's a socialist, and on the other hand, serving for 10 years in a centre-right government. I don't know what Bertie's interpretation of socialism is. I think it just means I'm a nice guy.
Socialism is about putting people before politics. I was elected on that mandate. I believe in that mandate. In everything I did in politics, I think I worked to prove that.
Asking the Taoiseach a question is like trying to play handball against a haystack. You hear a dull thud and the ball never comes back to you.
Bertie Ahern deliberately hides behind an exaggerated inarticulacy in order not to give clear-cut answers to anything, really.
I'll answer all the questions as best I can.
He makes a virtue out of it.
No, well, you see, because I would talk some in my Dublinese, and I suppose those people don't understand that, that they're not well-educated.
If I said so, I wasn't correct, so I can't recall if I did say, but if I did not say, or if I did say it, I didn't mean to say it.
You're asked, somebody says, I'll ask you a straight question, right? And then they'll ask you a straight question. But the straight question isn't straight at all. So the first thing you do is you pick up the bit of that question that isn't straight.
I try and give you the...
And then you give them 10 minutes of that. And by the time you get back to the straight bit, they'll all have gone for their break.
His strength came from his public image and the support that he got from people. He knew that was an enormous addition to the party.
I figure by now Bertie has met everyone in Ireland. Not once, not twice, maybe three times.
I mean, he entirely changed the way the office of Taoiseach is seen. There was no book launched or pub opened that he was not personally there.
He would shake hand after hand after hand, but he didn't spend more than about 2 or 3 seconds with anybody. He's a busy man, you know, he won't sit and have long conversations about things.
As Taoiseach, Bertie Ahern clocked up thousands of miles on the road. But for his last 4 years in office, he would do so alone.
When you no longer had Celia with you, was it more difficult being Taoiseach?
Yeah. I think these issues are tougher.
Celia devoted the best years of her life to Bertie Ahern. She worked for him. She made sure he got on politically and successful politically. She was there as his partner. As he himself described her, his lifelong partner.
I mean, I greatly appreciated my relationship, my partnership, and the fact that Celia was with me in those years.
And I believe Celia would like if the relationship had been regularised. Celia left Bertie because it came to the point where she could take no more.
The atmosphere was very strange. It was very uncomfortable. Personally, we felt it just wasn't right that this is what he had to do.
Well, I knew that interview was coming up, but I didn't watch it. I didn't want to go back on past occurrences, and I didn't want it to be discussed publicly.
Okay. And all phones are off, is that okay?
Yeah.
The trouble was that in the separation, I agreed to provide 20,000 for my children to an education account. It was part of the agreement that I made. Don't like having to give these details to my children, but for completeness. And I did that. And I also had to pay off other bills. So the money I'd saved was gone.
Did you understand that why he had to do it?
But that's his question. No, that's... I'll leave that one.
We were watching it, which was, of course, very emotional as a family member.
So my friends knew that. I'd no house was gone, so they decided to try and help me.
To see the emotion come out that you rarely see in Dad was just quite amazing. He was defending his honour, defending his whole life that he'd thrown himself into.
You know, it's just, it's hard to see anybody being put in such an intrusive position.
September 2006. Bertie Ahern reveals for the first time that he had taken cash from his friends.
There were friends of mine, and they were Joe Burke, Dermot Carew, Barry English.
They knew that he was going to give the names, and with Brian Dobson in the interview.
The money was raised by close friends.
And just to watch the text coming in one after another, and the phone ringing one after another. So.
The 6-1 interview was a high-risk attempt to deal with the news that the tribunal now had the Taoiseach in its sights.
Over the last number of years, a number of false allegations, half-truths, lies were made against me to both of the tribunals.
It was terrible because, I knew it was untrue. I mean, the trouble for me is when this thing started, I knew it was untrue. I mean, I've been dealing now 8.5 years with this stuff.
Bertie Ahern's problems stem from Tom Gilmartin, the developer who had first surfaced as a tribunal witness in the late 90s. Over the years, Gilmartin's allegations had widened. The tribunal chose to focus on those relating to his former business partner, Owen O'Callaghan.
Tom Gilmartin's allegation is that Owen O'Callaghan gave him to understand that he, O'Callaghan, had given money to Bertie Ahern, £50,000 in around 1989, another £30,000 sometime in between 89 and 92.
He made various allegations. He used to ring up and give all these allegations which were recorded by the tribunal, and he made loads and loads of these.
That I had bank accounts in the Netherlands, Antilles, that I had fixed the designation for Golden Island in Athlone for Owen O'Callaghan, and that I had 15 million in an offshore account.
And they changed, but I wasn't mentioned till way down the line. I mean, I was trying to run the country. I usually did look at this stuff on Saturday, Friday and Saturday night, and you're trying to answer in letters and you're getting big submissions from your legal people and you're into the courts and all of that. I never did get anything, so I wasn't maybe taking these things as serious as I was.
With Tom Gilmartin, there's been attempts to paint him as something of a loon, as a bit flaky, as a man with a grudge, a man with a mission. The problem for Fianna Fáil has been that in relation to the Pádraig Flynn evidence, for example, he was shown to be absolutely dead right. The stories he told about Liam Lawler as well turned out to be substantially true.
We also know from evidence at the tribunal that Owen O'Callaghan was paying large round figure sums to politicians, including Liam Lawler and indeed other councillors.
Both Owen O'Callaghan and Bertie Ahern have strenuously denied all of Tom Gilmartin's allegations, and specifically that Ahern received any money from O'Callaghan.
They now know what I had for my breakfast, my communion, my confirmation, my dinner, what I put into Miriam's account and Celia's account and everyone else's account, but there is no evidence. I never got a penny from Mr. Gilmartin or Mr. O'Callaghan. I got nothing from them.
I said to my son, I'm going to give this man a good shake hand. And I'm going to clap him on the shoulder. My son smiles. He says, don't break his shoulder, father.
Bertie, once he begins something, he never leaves it there. Look at the handshake with Paisley. Who would have thought it possible?
It just released, as it were, feelings that were held back for years by both parts of this island.
In 2007, after nearly a decade of false dawns, Northern Ireland's past seemed to have settled on a future.
I mean, a lot of these negotiations over 10 years, a lot of these were as difficult, sometimes more difficult, in a funny way, than the Good Friday Agreement. We were there with Mark McGuinness and Ian Paisley, and everything came together.
I think it was quite an emotional moment for both of us because we realised that all that work had finally borne fruition.
It wasn't a question of celebration, we were just relieved.
I mean, the one thing I'm absolutely sure of is it would not have happened without his contribution, for sure.
I believe Northern Ireland has come to a time of peace.
In the Republic, the decade-long boom continued. Bertie Ahern seemed set for an election he had to call by June. In the background, though, there was always a relentless pressure.
We had got the material based on his private interviews with the tribunal and those of others, including Michael Wall and Celia Larkin. So he was aware that the Mail was going to publish on Sunday details, very embarrassing details, concerning his personal finances and his explanations to the tribunal about them.
I got a phone call at 1 a.m. We knew something was going to happen, but when? No one knew. This was extraordinary. And I'm saying, someone said he's going to the park at 6 in the morning. I said, I never thought.
Are you nervous?
Why did you do it like this?
Jesus, are you nervous?
I knew that certain elements of the media were going to come at us. We were going for a third term, and most of them didn't want to see me get a third term.
We probably left it go a wee bit up to the wire. So then Sunday morning, early was the time.
As soon as they blamed me for getting them out of bed in the morning, I knew we were in for a rough time.
Oh, I just said, here, we got problems now.
The first 2 weeks were very difficult. We were on the back foot. I think the mood, who the hell got, was shocking.
I think it was wittily described as meltdown manner. He left the party headquarters and devoted himself to canvassing in the constituency, although he was the party leader.
He was grumpy. There was one extraordinary press conference in the street where questions were brought up about his finances, and he literally stayed silent.
Next question, please.
He received £30,000 in sterling in cash from Micheál Wall in your office at St. Luke's. Why didn't you tell us last September about this?
Vincent, I'll deal with all those issues, but that money was not money from me.
No matter where he went, no matter what he wanted to talk about in relation to the election campaign, it still came back to this whole question of the money.
Vincent! It is incredible.
That was not my money. That was not my money.
You know, there was the difficulty in the middle of the election with Michael Madol doing a press conference and all of that.
But it's essential that the Taoiseach must make a comprehensive statement addressing all the new information now in the public domain.
To be honest with you, I don't know what he was at, but I mean, you know, that's, and I didn't watch him tomorrow, so I don't know what he said either.
The Taoiseach was eventually persuaded not to jump ship mid-campaign, but now senior members of his own party had questions for Bertie Ahern.
Yeah, well, first of all, say about that, and I think it's important for me to say this, I was not summoned anywhere by Brian Cahan.
Remember that we were penciled in to do the press conference, just the three of us, on that Sunday.
There were three senior ministers going to be present. One was Micheál Martin, the other Dermot Aran, and Brian Cahan.
I think we said, well, can we talk to the Taoiseach about this as well? We felt that going out to St. Luke's would have looked fairly dramatic and unnecessary, whereas the natural thing anyway was we all met in headquarters.
I was going to talk to Brian, and then I said to the others, listen, come on in and we'll talk about this. And I did.
In Bertie's style, he talked us through it, you know. In a matter of fact, when you're kind of listening, yeah, okay. We said, look, we feel, you know, you're going to have to make a statement of this at some stage. He said, yeah. You know, we felt comfortable enough to go out and do other things then at the press conference in terms of, you know, why was it leaked? Who was behind the leak of material?
Fine Gael leader, I understand, was talking on the side of his mouth before the election campaign.
Fine Gael are saying things privately to people.
But it was as though Cowan took over as leader of the party on that day and effectively remained so.
It's all related to my judicial separation. That's how the Taoiseach this morning sought to finally end the speculation over his finances.
And that was the turning point, you know, when he agreed to clarify it. We were then able to get into the campaign proper.
While the media storm raged, public support for the Taoiseach seemed to grow. For Bertie Ahern, the election was back on track.
But he then had things planned in the middle of the campaign. Which fell right from the Westminster speech, was a key, in my view, was a key turning point as well.
Peace in Ireland has been the work of a generation. And today I salute all those who helped to lay the foundation for what has now taken shape.
You move on to the debate with Linda Kenny, following hot on its heels.
I now know that you, as a matter of choice, that you have decided that the top 3% should gain the most.
I have decided.
I think that's inequitable.
He wins that debate.
Well, it's almost decision time.
I watched him in Westminster, and what I saw actually was quite a small, battered man from Drumcondra, like getting praise abroad, and coming home to the most squalid and sordid and mean-minded campaign I've seen in my lifetime.
Owen.
And then suddenly we're into 4 or 5 days into the polling day with a kind of momentum behind us. It's extraordinary.
The party feeling that the tide is beginning to turn for them.
And ultimately, I think in this election, the last election, they saw that, you know, the devil you know is better than the devil you don't know.
The main question to be answered appears to be not will Fianna Fáil lead the next government, but with whom will they form that government?
So far, they've held on to all of their seats.
The PDs are in very big trouble.
I love my country. I am deeply ambitious for it. As far as I'm concerned, my period in public life as a public representative is over.
Once again, Bertie Ahern had outfought and outlived his critics. The remarkable campaign comeback, a testament to his enduring popularity.
And so, by 89 votes to 76, Bertie Ahern was elected Taoiseach for a third term, the first since De Valera to win 3 successive election victories.
Yes, but I mean, everything about Bertie Ahern is unprecedented. I mean, the man managed to get himself elected 3 times as Taoiseach in the modern era, which is highly unusual.
And so it was a great pride, an acute sense of responsibility, that I accept the nomination of Dáil Éireann for the office of Taoiseach.
Bertie Ahern has had to operate under the arc lights for a long time.
But at the height of his success, Bertie Ahern revealed that his days in office were numbered.
Are you going to run the full 5 years?
I intend to stay till 2012, Charlie, but you know, five years is a long time.
Sometime during that 5 years, the party will have to choose a new leader. As Bertie Ahern has said, he will retire before the next election.
I think he was probably trying to be fair to people, saying that I'm not going to be here forever. But I think it was wrong that he shouldn't have done it.
I think once you say you're not going to be around, the power begins to ooze away. People realise there's going to be another act.
He's a hugely, hugely experienced politician, from my point of view, and it's obviously the party will ultimately decide, but my point of view, he is the obvious successor to me in 5 years' time or whenever.
I don't think he was right in doing that either.
And I give a straight answer to a straight question asked by a straight journalist, Sean O'Rourke.
I think that his decision to announce his intention to depart immediately put his government in a vulnerable position. But knowing what we know about the evidence at the tribunal, it may have been his judgment that it was prudent for him to indicate to the public that he would depart during the course of term of this government.
For Bertie Ahern, the Mahon Tribunal must have been like Chinese water torture. It was drip, drip, drip.
Morning, everybody.
How are you feeling?
Not a bother, Nick.
He was under pressure to explain his purchase of £30,000 sterling,
political donation for personal use from a businessman who is now
about
dead.
Acquiring £22,500.
Unique opportunity to see the Taoiseach up close and personal, giving evidence about his private life in public.
Some of the questioning was ludicrous, to be honest. Who was in his bedroom? Who could sleep in his bedroom?
He left to a familiar chorus of cheers and boos.
But I suppose when you sit there, it's slightly grubby in a certain way. You feel slightly uncomfortable that someone has to go through that, even if you ultimately think they should.
It takes a lot of commitment, Charlie, but you have to do it. But I have been dealing with it now for a long number of years.
I think he is a very sensitive man, actually. Although he's very strong-willed and he's been very strong through his whole life in politics, I think he is a worrier and quite an emotional, sensitive person.
As well as stupid. I mean, I've answered.
He isn't a calm person. If you sit and you watch Bertie, he's a deeply, deeply wound-up person. He's sitting and he has the chin down and the mouth goes in like a duck's ass, you know?
Dig out for Christmas. Help yourself.
There was a lot of confusion as far as the ordinary person is concerned.
You come back after lunch?
No. So there's a lot of unexplained answers.
You were asleep.
I don't know.
At the start of 2008, the tribunal seemed to be getting nowhere. and the turning point when it came had nothing to do with the original allegations against Bertie Ahern.
Celia Larkin has told the tribunal how she needed the original loan to buy the house where her two elderly aunts lived for over 60 years.
What changed everything was that in 2008, the Irish Permanent discovered archival records in Drumcondra. They went back to 1994, when the tribunal was following money trails. One of the trails led to this BT account.
The tribunal is investigating the so-called BT account, which was used to advance a loan of £30,000 to Miss Larkin.
I think the revelation that £30,000 of the party's money had gone to Celia Larkin to buy a house and only been paid back, obviously, when the tribunal found out about it. I think that would damage him with party activists.
Miss Larkin, have you anything to say about the tribunal revelations?
People who would normally support Bertie felt that this was inappropriate, that this was wrong. It did go down badly with the party from one end of the country to the other.
Former Drumcondra branch manager Blair Hughes said he remembers Bertie Ahern's secretary making sterling lodgements.
Bertie Ahern had already given his evidence that his lodgements to these accounts were his salary checks. He'd failed to mention the fact that he'd lodged £15,000 sterling to his own accounts in 1994. So the thought that was on everybody's mind was, how is he going to explain this?
Bertie Ahern would later explain that he had often changed Irish cash from his salary into sterling on trips to Manchester, and that he had won some of it at the races.
First of all, the bank evidence shows that they weren't all sterling. And the ones that were sterling, I've given the explanations of why they were sterling. And I explained in detail out of that 15,500 that about 1,500 of it was a bet.
Later, Mr. Hearn's former secretary, Grainne Carruth, became tearful as she accepted she made the lodgements contrary to earlier evidence.
The pressure of me having to do the Dáil, then to do European Council, and then to go to America, and before I'm back, she's in.
She was very nervous. At times, she was tearful. I suppose it's fair to say that the tribunal piled the pressure on.
Well, if it was put to her, she could end up in jail.
She didn't change her evidence. She simply said that on the basis of the documentation, she accepted that she must have made sterling lodgements, but said she had no memory of it.
The way everything was seen by your average person on the street and your average member of the organisation, yeah, that was bad.
At one stage she moaned, I just want to go home.
Why they had to engage in such haste around that, to me, seemed unfair, and I'd say no more than that.
I think that fatally damaged his public image.
So now you're in a scenario where you have this tribunal going on, there's different revelations coming out, the media are sitting on every revelation.
All people want to ask is about the Mahan tribunal. I can appreciate that. That's what sells newspapers.
What was your view on the revelation last week? What's your view on the revelation this week?
Do you believe his accounts? Do you believe his stories so far?
It's not a matter for me to believe or otherwise.
It was becoming a significant distraction.
I'm simply saying there was considerable public disquiet as a result of Grainne Carruth's evidence last week.
But he says still that he didn't personally lodge sterling. Like, someone seriously.
No, he got a secretary to do it. A secretary lodged sterling.
I don't think a single minister went to him and suggested that he should consider his position. He was able to work it out himself.
Did Brian Kyne or anyone else put you under pressure to resign?
Nobody put me under pressure. The only one to put me under any pressure was myself.
We knew on the Sunday before, the whole family kind of gathered. He just very calmly and patiently, you know, calmly said, yeah, and I'm going to announce that I'm stepping down.
I guess we were still quite shocked to hear him say it.
I discussed it with my daughters. I spoke to Celia Larkin. I spoke to Miriam.
I felt he was right when he was telling me that that's what he was doing. And probably a little bit relieved for him. I thought things were getting a little bit too uncomfortable.
And I rang a few people that were close to me.
I got a call and he said certain things to me, and I knew from what he said that he was going to announce his resignation.
The night before, I went for a drink with a few of my friends, a few of the guys who financially helped me, and we had our mind made up and we just went and nothing.
When I woke up next morning and it seemed business as usual, you turn on the radio and it's all very normal.
Good morning. It's 7 o'clock on Wednesday, the 2nd of April.
Coming up as the dial returns, just what will the Taoiseach say about Stirling to keep his smaller partners and government satisfied? And
I knew that the call I'd had the night before, that it wasn't going to be an ordinary day.
Certainly I can say from myself, and I would safely say from around the cabinet table, there wasn't any sense of what was about to happen.
But I could sense there was some tension in the room because ministers had been getting texts from their press officers to await a public statement by the Taoiseach at 10 o'clock.
Suddenly I saw Mary Hennifin sort of put her hand on his shoulder and I said, what's going on? And then people were looking at her texting like hell.
We were very surprised when he gathered together a few foolscap pages on which he had his own handwritten notes.
We were short of paper the week before that, Luke, so I was writing it on the back of sheets.
Suddenly he said, well, I'm going to America and I'm coming back on the 6th of May and I'm resigning.
I think the initial reaction was one of shock. He clearly was upset himself.
I have to say it was emotional, yes. I think you'd want to be made of stone. You'd have to have felt from that morning because it was sad.
Yeah, and slow.
For most of us, sense of shock. It was the end of an era.
Mixture of surprise, sadness, and in another sense, that he was doing the right thing.
In fact, the only sorry thing I had in hindsight that I got wrong, I should have called the press conference at 6 o'clock and got the media out of bed again.
Thank you very much for your attendance at short notice. I've been privileged to serve my community and my party and our country for many years in public life. In that period, I'm proud to have made a contribution to an unrivaled era of peace, prosperity and progress on this island.
It was my own speech.
I want everyone to understand one truth above all else. Never in all the time I served in public life have I ever put my personal interests ahead of the public good.
He certainly disliked the fact that a tribunal had been able, in effect, to remove him from office. That is how he saw it.
And following on from my return from the United States, it is my intention to tender my resignation to President McAleese on Tuesday, the 6th of May.
And I do have to say that it's questionable whether a Taoiseach should be removed under those circumstances.
Bertie Ahern today brought down the curtain on a remarkable political career.
In April 2008, Bertie Ahern announced he would resign as Taoiseach after more than a decade in power.
Take care.
Thank you.
Before he left, however, there was a final lap to run.
After so many decades of conflict, I am so proud, Madam Speaker, to be the first Irish leader to inform the United States Congress Ireland is at peace.
His big point was Ireland is at peace. That's some achievement, and nobody can ever take that away from him.
That is why, with all our faults as human beings, we seek the honour of representing the people.
I'll say, because I've been through tribunals for 10 years, everybody knows what I've done. It's cost me a fortune, it's cost me everything I had. I've been, you know, trampled all over the international press for one bad thing in all my political years. And it's just been a horrendous start to finish, and I did absolutely nothing wrong.
What I would say to you is, he's a simple person who's never lost sight of where he came from and where he's going.
This is not a man who's amassed a fortune as Taoiseach or as leader of the opposition.
And I am absolutely certain that my brother is not motivated by money.
Bertie Ahern left office without evident personal wealth, but for a time at least, his finances were complex.
Comes full circle, I can tell you that.
I don't think it's right to take money if you're a minister to accept gifts from friends, even in entirely proper circumstances. I think it can give rise to difficulties. But I think, you know, in the judgment of history, whatever is established by the tribunal will be a very small account compared to his achievements.
Demand tribunal. It has to believe that banking records are wrong. It has to believe that it's a coincidence that Stirling just keeps on popping up. You know, there's just too much that is so bizarre.
Well, I don't accept that Bertie Ahern is as much part of the old guard. There is absolutely no way Bertie Ahern would have achieved a third term if he had been
materially the same caliber and character of person as Ray Burke and Mr. Hyde.
He has reunited the party, and no leader managed to bring that party together as much as Bertie Ahern did.
What did drive Bertie Ahern? He worked unceasingly for 30 years, but rarely spelled out his vision.
He sees politics as a practical business of getting the day's work shifted and moving on to the next day. But on the other hand, you do look back at 10 years during which emigration is pretty well stopped, when there is continuing peace in Northern Ireland, and you can't really just throw it out the window and say, why didn't he make better speeches?
His principal legacy, I think, is having squandered a decade of growth without giving us the strength to withstand many of the difficulties that we have today.
But overall, the economy has changed dramatically. He is associated with the boom times. The end of his tenure was the bust time.
In office, Bertie Ahern made himself accessible to the Irish people as never before, but he remained impenetrable to those around him.
I think his greatest is that he keeps his counsel to himself. Very few people know what Bertie is thinking about.
He's a solitary figure, yes. I think he has a lot of social friends and that, but I think, you know, when it comes down to it, it's he himself within himself.
I mean, I've been lucky. Like any politician, you get a few lows, but I mean, I've got a lot of high points that, you know, things that are good memories.
Think that his legacy will be good. And I don't think we're finished with him yet.
I don't think he's going to step out of the limelight. I think he has his eye on the park. He's used to being in that sort of spotlight. And it's going to be very, very hard for him to leave it.
Bertie Ahern has spent his adult life in the public gaze. A TD at 25, Taoiseach at 45. Still in his 50s, he resigned before he felt his time was up. The journey from Drumcondra to the pinnacle of national politics has been long and eventful. A journey that is perhaps not yet complete.
I'd like to, you know, make a contribution. Now, what I miss is not making a contribution. I mean, I enjoy politics. If there are other challenges, maybe, maybe not. I don't intend doing nothing. What's good about politics is you feel you're doing something.
And next Monday at 9:30, the award-winning Primetime Investigates returns with a new series, and the first programme exposes discrimination against the travelling community. Later, Brian Dobson meets Anthony Cronin on 1-to-1 at 11:45, but next it's questions and answers, and John Bowman has more on that in just a few moments.